Dan zitten we met Elmer. Elmer,
ik ga weg.
Ja, ik kan het zeggen, want jij zit anders precies met je hoofd over je hoofd in het zicht.
Lekker.
Ja,
dat is een beetje raar in het
zicht. Zit ik zo beter?
Pas wel.
Ja, ik kom zo. Ik zit ook met de kabels voor de audio, hè? Oké. Oh, dank je.
Ik wil met je elleboog bewegen.
Oké. Goed, neemt hij op?
Ja, volgens mij. Ja.
Neemt hij al op of?
Ja, als het goed is. Nee. Ja, dat zien we.
Nou, oké, welkom. Deze lecture is wederom in het Engels. Wordt opgenomen. Ja. Anna, blijf zien. Dit is Oscar Koura, hij vertelt zo direct nog wat meer over wie hij is, wat hij doet. Ik ken Oscar al een tijdje, ik ben heel blij dat je weer bent gekomen voor de guest lecture. Ik vond dat hartstikke leuk. Nou, studenten, toevallig studenten van vorig jaar had gesproken, die zullen ongetwijfeld beamen. Heel veel humor, maar ook een behoorlijk, af en toe pittig technisch verhaal. Dus zoals altijd, let goed op. PK, SSL, het is ook een van de kernonderdelen uiteraard weer bij de tentaminering aan het eind. Zet alsjeblieft de telefoons en dus enzovoorts uit, zoveel mogelijk, dat we niet allerlei rare geluiden hebben door de opname heen. Ja, dat is eigenlijk in een notendop, dus Elmer, moet je hem nog een cut-off hebben? Dus
ja,
3, 2, 1.
Yeah! Ja, misschien kan ik wel beginnen met alle telefoons die afgaan, worden een onderdeel van de demonstratie. Maar goed, dat komen we zo meteen wel even op af. English switching. So, topic of the day is public key infrastructure and transport layer security. Also known as SSL, TLS, SSL, what's the difference? I'm not going to dive into the real technical details of why and how these two differ. There's a difference. There's a technical difference. These days we have to refer to transport layer security and not secure session layer, which was the old names. These are two topics which are tied together, intertwined. Sometimes they are used in different ways, and I hope to tell you a lot of things about that. Too fast. Best terug? Okay. Who am I? I used to work at a laboratory on the other side of Amsterdam. Actually, it's more or less this side of Amsterdam, in the science park. It was the National Subatomic Physics Lab, and I worked there as systems programmer, hacking OpenSSL, extending OpenSSL libraries, making new implementations for grid computing infrastructures and supercomputing infrastructures, being able to tie these types of big-ass resources together globally for the Higgs boson particle endeavors and discovery, for instance, and all related sciences which have to do with the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. I've used to be doing this work for 10 years, making prototypes and working with a lot of HVA students at the time. I've done this beautiful job for 10 years and I switched to another beautiful company, which is called KPN. And I've had the opportunity to work at the Chief Information Security Office. And I'm a member of the red team, so there are three teams in the CISO office. A strategy and policy team, which focus on preventative actions, new policies for the entire company. There's a red team, which is what I'm doing, actively looking at security problems on request, or not on request, but we have the opportunity to pen test ourselves, and there's a core team in this company that can actually do this. This is new, not all the companies have this. Only a few have them. So I had the opportunity to hack a pen test for a living, and loving it ever since. Future, yeah, well, who knows what the future is. I'll leave that one open. The goal of today, we're going to talk about the basic principles of TLS and PKI. What is a certificate? Being able to analyze a TLS handshake in depth, talk about good practices, bad practices along the way. At the end there are some case studies, depending on how fast I can go. There are quite some case studies. It's going to be a stretch. Just for the hint, I have about 154 slides and I wasn't really done. This is without the actual exercises. So what I'm going to do is make the last part, the practical part, more like a walkthrough. Otherwise we won't make it. Pop quiz. These terms on the board, SSL, TLS, AES, EC, DH. Does anybody know a few of them? Raise your hand. A few. Okay, who dares to state they know all of them? Or at least heard of each of them? Okay, obvious. So, do we know what AES is to start with? Ever heard of it?
Advanced Encryption Scheme.
Bingo. Do you know the varieties of where they come from?
In bit length, they vary 265, I think.
Okay, good. Very well. SHA, do we know what this is? SHA. Very quiet. Hashing algorithms. Probably you don't. So if you look at certificates and so on, you'll see these terms. If you look at TLS, SSL handshakes, you see these terms slide by. The end of this course, you will know mostly to all of them. Does anybody know what EAP stands for, or at least what it is? You don't care. Everybody uses Eduroam, right? Or at least most of you? Okay. It's one of those things where it's not particularly a website with an HTTPS protocol where we use TLS or certificates. It's a different protocol to authenticate yourself to the wireless network. Your credentials will be sent to a centralized radio system and then onto an LDAP system backend to verify if your account is what it is. EAP is a completely different way of transporting these credentials securely. It's a different way, a different method, but the same things apply as the security for websites. We're going to focus primarily on the website case. I will dive into some dangers on Android phones and limitations in Android phones and so on. And yeah, we'll see how far we can get with this. It's everywhere. HTTPS, well, maybe you know most of these terms, I hope. WebDAV, HTTPS, SMTPS, FTP, SSL. SSL is really used in all kinds of products. It's used from really small embedded devices up to enterprise level big systems that we know and love today, or websites. If we don't have it, we really would have a big problem because everything would be unencrypted and credentials would not be encrypted over the wire and so on. It really goes from application level protocols for HTTP, for instance, up to core protocols for DNS, like DNSSEC and how that is used. I'm not going to dive into DNSSEC, but I really want to note that these kinds of protocols are really the core of why and how we can securely do web and mobile banking, for instance, how we can authenticate securely on Google infrastructure, for instance, or any other application on other means, how DigiD works and how EID works, for instance, in the future, how we have a safe tax system, which is based on not just paperwork anymore. I really hated the paperwork tax stuff. I love it that everything becomes digital, but now we have new questions to ask. How is this securely implemented? Techniques on how this is used will be discussed. Remote desktop protocols, hardware, software. Another interesting way of how it's used is these days with hardware and software licenses. Typically you use something like a certificate or another hashed file, a special file that you can download from a vendor, can install it, and suddenly your machine has new capabilities. Or your software is currently licensed in some way. It's especially with software like AutoCAD or stuff that's really being published on Pirate Bay in all kinds of ways because it's really expensive software. They tend to use really strong solutions to save their software, so to speak, license wise. Okay. So we're going to talk about this padlock in the corner, mostly, because this is what symbolizes SSL and a proper TLS handshake, a proper secure connection to a site that you might trust or might not. In this case, couldn't say anything bad about this one, but it could be your bank or anything else. So, TLS. Where does it reside with respect to the protocol stack? In a typical connection, when you have a web connection, HTTPS in this case, it would be up here. You would have a TCP handshake. There's a stateful connection. And above this stage, so then when this stateful connection is done, so there's a session, you can start a specific TLS handshake, which is a specific protocol in itself, the handshake protocol. You have a cipher change protocol, an alert protocol, and a record protocol. And in the record protocol, this is where the data is being moved back and forth. This is after the handshake is done. You've changed your ciphers, and there's there's an alert protocol. This could be a good thing or a bad thing, like a hint we need to do something about our session, or the session needs to be broken because there's something bad happened or something is compromised along the way. This is what's all in this TLS protocol. So there's a lot. It's not just we have some secure connection and we're done. This is going to be explained in detail. Above this and transporting the data is, of course, the HTTP protocol. So HTTPS technically doesn't really exist. At least I always symbolize it myself as an HTTP and an SSL connection. So you have your SSL connection, and then above this you have an HTTP protocol being moved back and forth. Obviously, this is not the only solution or way of doing TLS. The other ways of doing TLS is, of course, using UDP packets. For instance, OpenVPN uses UDP and then sets up a TLS handshake. Or you have EAP. And EAP is a special protocol which is part of the 802.1x standard, which is what basically is the EDIROM system, or at least the wireless communication and session, the entire logon process is using EAP. Just to keep it short and simple. Within the EAP packets, as a you can actually call it just an attribute, as an attribute to the EAP packets, is the outer layer EAP packets, there's the entire TLS handshake going on. So the messages are embedded within a totally different protocol and move over the network. Purpose of the transport layer security protocol is to get secure. How do you get secure? Or what is this security and how do we get it? There are three main pillars: integrity control, confidentiality, and authenticity. You might figure out, okay, this is what you mean, but let's dive into the other colors, which are not. So if you have a solution, if you make an application, you figure out a way to code your own SSL implementation, or somebody already created one, and as it happens in the news a few days ago, somebody broke it, or somebody discovered that it was broken. Then the solution or the SSL implementation moves out of the secure area, and either you have the problem of you perhaps cannot really manipulate the data in the stream. It is encrypted, but somehow the recipient is not verified. This means there's no authenticity. You don't know who you're talking to. This means you have a perfectly valid encrypted connection, but you're not talking to a bank, you're talking to my laptop in between. For example. Just an example. Demos later. In another area where you have a problem of, okay, you don't have the confidentiality anymore, it might be that you have a very nice connection. The session is not manipulable. Recipients are identified, but it's not encrypted. Anybody have an example for this, perhaps? VPNs. Some VPNs have a very nice way of doing integrity control. They also have an identification phase. They authenticate it to the other peer. You get, yes, I can only set up a connection to you. But if you Wireshark it, you will figure out that it's not encrypted. Is it secure? No, absolutely not. In the other area, manipulation is possible. You have an encrypted connection, a very hard one to figure out and beat, but there is a way to being able to manipulate the data that flows into the encrypted layer. It is encrypted, you know exactly who you're talking to, but people could change the message or figure out and tool the message. So, SSL and TLS and all the other solutions basically, they all focus on this secure bit here, where integrity, confidentiality, and authenticity is controlled, and they have a solution for this. And one of the things to figure out, of course, one of the things to do is create confidentiality by encryption. Nobody should be able to read it. We have a few ways of doing this encryption. We can generalize in symmetric and asymmetric encryption solutions. Symmetric encryption is the AES cipher, for instance. Methods of AES, well, there are a few varieties of AES, and we're not going into the details of the varieties of CBS and electronic code book varieties, but it boils down, there is a key, there's a shared key, and with this shared key you can set up an encrypted protocol, an encrypted session. The same holds for triple DES or other symmetric ciphers. This means somehow you have to communicate to the other side that you have this secret key, and you have to with this secret key you have to set up this session or connection. With asymmetric encryption, RSA, DSA, varieties of elliptic curve encryption, this means there are split keys. You use two keys to do the encryption. You have a private key and you've got a public key. private key, always keep this one private. The public key you can send to the other side and work with this. Obviously there are more types of ciphers. They have, you have classical ways of substitution and transformation. Anybody know ROT 13, for instance? Yes? Well, it's essentially it's a substitution encryption, nothing more than this. On the other hand, you have the rotor machines. Anybody have an interesting example of a rotor machine?
Second World War, the Germans?
Enigma. Bingo. In modern times, you now have the private key and public key, of which the private key part, you of course have stream ciphers and block ciphers. So, AES in short, and just real short, because there's a huge mathematical proof of why this works, how this works, and so on. I will not bore you with that, because it would be a talk in itself. Essentially, you start from the top, and you have something that's called key expansion. This is actually outside of the scope of AES, but this is one of those first steps. AES, depending on the variety and flavor of AES, you always use a key of 32 bits. So the key expansion means you put it through, for instance, another algorithm, SHA-256, or anything else, and you use the 32 bits output of the hash algorithm to use a small password, and this small password you can hash, and you have a long string, and that is what you can use as the actual key. Otherwise it would be 0000123, which is not a real strong password or way of encryption, because then everybody could break the AES encryption. So what happens is you add a round key. This means you have these rounds, so you have the key and you make a step and turn it. You substitute some bytes, you shift some rows, so you have to figure this out as a matrix, as a grid. And you put all the text that you really want to shuffle in a block cipher, for instance, and you have to shift them in rows, mix the columns, add a round key again. And this is what you do 9, 11, or 13 times, depending on the AES flavor you use. Then you do this one more time to finish off, and you're done. This is AES in short. In a similar way, this is RSA. Yes? So, we've got Alice and Bob. They've got a private key, they've got a public key. We're going to send some message to the other side. And this means you have to, Bob in this case has to communicate his public key to Alice. And with this, she can encrypt a ciphertext with his public key, sends it over the wire. Eve can try to snoop it, doesn't understand what's going on and doesn't understand the ciphertext. And Bob can decrypt it. How does this one work? Let's have a walkthrough. So you choose two prime numbers and multiply them to be used as the modulus n. Can somebody tell me? Okay, so I already figured out a few because I've pre-computed this, of course. But prime numbers, take one.
3, 5, 7.
3, 5, 7. Is some more?
13. Mm-hmm. 75.
Go on. Okay. So, in the next step, you choose a co-prime E. What's a co-prime? A co-prime is when you have these two numbers, and they're both prime, and what you figure out is that one of those should be prime relative to another one. Yes? No? Okay. I'll get to this. There's a rule to this. Whatever you choose as a co-prime E, this is going to be the public key. It has to be smaller than n, but bigger than 1. E is also is co-prime to this equation. Get into detail on this. Calculate D. D is something you can calculate from the P and Q again, especially now you have E. So now you can figure out D. And this needs to be equal to 1. And obviously, don't forget the last step. This destroy P and Q, where you actually started this entire equation from. So the result is M, E, and D. Should be careful with this. Next. So, let's choose 11 and 29. And we calculate N, and this is 319. To figure out what E is, we need to figure out a co-prime to P minus 1 times Q minus 1 is, well, 10 and 28. It's 280. Obviously, we use advanced tools like for this. So if you go to Wolfram Alpha, you type in co-prime of 280, and you hit more. You hit it a few times, eventually you'll get this entire list all the way to 1, because it's a heavy calculation for Wolfram Alpha as well. And it only gives you about 20 results or so, but this is a huge list of about 100 results, so you have to tick more about 5 times. And then you get all the co-primes of 280, because technically it's infinity, but there's a rule to this. And obviously what you can see is that these are all prime. And they're also prime relative to 280. Okay, so next step. We choose 3 out of this list, just to keep it with small numbers. D is something we can now calculate with respect to, well, okay, 3 times x mod 280 is 1. Again, we hit Wolfram Alpha. For this, and ask for the solution to solve 3 times x mod 280 is 1. The fun part is that Wolfram Alpha actually came back with, it's this. Well, if you figure out and you deduct 280 from 467, you'll end up with a smaller number, which is 187. So, we now know this is 187. So we now have our private key and our public key. 3 and 187. So then we do this again. With Alex, Bob, and Dr. Riva. You have this message. You have this E is the public key. D is the private key. And N is the shared modulus. So what we're doing now is I need new batteries. 65. This is, and if we calculate M to the E is 3 mod 319. They come up to the number 285. You can calculate this if you're fast enough with anything else, but another calculator. Dr. Evo just sees 65. By the way, on the ASCII table, what's 65? Come on. I mean, we can run with numbers, but the idea is text or something else human. I don't regard myself human all the time, but sometimes I do. So 65 is an A, capital A. Oh. Stupid thing. I'm not going to use this anymore. So, you see 285, and then obviously if you calculate D to the power of 187 mod 319, it would be 65 again. If you don't believe me, type it in a calculator and go nuts. Now we go to the other part, which is integrity. One of the things that we use integrity control for is, or at least we gain it, with something called data origin authentication. This basically means the use of cryptographic hash functions. Ah, you have another one. Yes, this is a keyboard. I don't have a button. It's a Mac. They put in a new keyboard. It says, oh, yeah, you have to push this button next to the shift key. I don't have one. Okay, so. Cryptographic hash functions. One-way hash functions. It's one of those, it's a core element in Mac. Not this Mac, but cryptographic Mac. Nice disambiguity ambiguity on Wikipedia, for instance, Mac. Message authentication code. It's a keyed hash message authentication code. You can, and the beauty is, you can verify both the data integrity and the authentication of authenticity of the message. So you can figure out who sent it. You can figure, because it's a digital signature, for instance, you can figure out who sent it and that this message was not tampered with along the transportation of it. So cryptographic hash functions, perhaps you've seen this one before. You put in Fox and you use a cryptographic hash function and mumbo jumbo comes up, but it's always a fixed length stuff that comes up to digest. If you put in another piece of text which is longer, you get the same digest length, but it's always different. Any bit that flips or changes on this end, like for instance here a few letters that move, will create a completely different digest output. Any bit in the first step will change it completely. Anybody up for a stab on which cryptographic hash function this is? Good guess. Probably a very lucky guess. So, a Mac. How does this work? Just guessing on the fact that it's lucky, but maybe you're darn good and we want to hire you. A sender uses a key, and this holds for, this is basically how Mac works in a very generic way. So you have a key, a algorithm for Mac usage, which is SHA plus whatever flavor or variety of Mac you use. And eventually you end up with a message and a Mac, also known, or better known, as a digital signature, for instance. It's one of those uses. On the other side, the receiver can use the key, the Mac algorithm, and figure out if his calculation for the Mac is equal to what it was sent. So if a digital signature was sent with the message, and through the use of the same key that they somehow have, if another result comes out, it means the message was tampered with. Also, it tells you that the other owner of the key is the one who sent it to you, because it would be the only one who would be capable of constructing with this message exactly this Mac value. The HMAC variety uses a shared key. It's one key to rule them all between those two pairs in this case. In this case, a very interesting supercomputer, old one, and some old-fashioned IBM. You create a signature, you send the message plus the signature to the other side, and it is capable of doing the verification. Another variety is the digital signature algorithm. This is used with certificates, for instance. It's where you have a sender's private key, or before, if you have encrypted email or signed email. I should say signed email is a very good example. If you have a the sender is capable of using its private key to create the signature, and anybody who possesses the public key, which is publicly known, or you can publish this on your website or so on, is capable of verifying that this message was really from you and it was not changed or tampered with along the way. Now we go down to the authenticity step. This is going to be a big one, because encryption was the simple one. There are two ways of using, so there are two common ways, or two popular ways of doing authenticity checks. There are many, but the biggest, most important ones use certificates in the public key infrastructure. And the other well-known method is PGP certificates in the Web of Trust. Raise your hands, except two that are actually, no, three, four that are actually signed the key with. Who has PGP?
I use the link.
At least you heard of it. PGP works completely different than public key infrastructure. You create your own key, you create your own certificate, you set your own email address or anything on it. And instead of a centralized authority, you ask somebody else to verify your identity and your credentials and your statements on the certificates, and then sign it with their private key. So this means I can download a certificate from my pgp.surfnet.nl or any other site at MIT or something. I can download it and I can verify this offline, face to face preferably. And I can check the signature, I can check all the details, the fingerprints, the email address is set on these, and I can upload this signed statement to the services again, because this is a publicly accessible statement. And therefore you can build up a web of trust. I trust you, you trust me. Other people have some kind of trust expression to a person. And you can figure this out, and this is very strongly linked to the identities of all the other people. Very nice way. We're going to dive into public key infrastructure because there are more details to this, and PGP is not that well known. So, what's a certificate? This is a certificate. Yes? Well, this is spam encoded, so it's not really the actual certificate. If we look through a more meaningful way, or look with a more meaningful way, we can use a web browser, for instance, to read a certificate from a site. This is because there's a communication going on, there's a session, there's an exchange of certificates, and if I go to this this website, I get this certificate. And it's parsed, and I can look at all the values that are in it. And I can see that it's for this website, kpn.com. Could be any. So a certificate. There's public information and there's the private key. Actually, a certificate is only the public information part. It's not per se the keys what matters in certificates. Yes, it's really important, but what's really important as an important takeaway, if you ever install it on a web server, for instance, you have to ensure that the private key is installed in a very secure way, preferably in a hardware encrypted module or anything else fancy, or at least ensure that the file system permissions are as strict as possible so that nobody else can actually try to read it. That's the private key. The public key, however, tells you a lot of things about this relationship, or at least is the public key is the relationship between the keys. And the data of it tells stuff about the actual owner of the key. So certificates can tell a lot about the site, about the owner, about who signed it, what type of trust relationship do they have, all kinds of things. So let's go through this more structured thing. On a certificate, there's a public key. Could be an RSA, a DSA, or an elliptic curve keeper. Public key, of course. There's a signature from an authority. This is the same method of signatures that I just explained with digital signature. There's usability information, like what is the purpose of this certificate? What can you do with this? Is this for a web server? Is this for a VPN system? Is this for a Microsoft domain controller? Is this for a person? Is this used for Java code signing? This is what can be scoped into a certificate and what is stated on the certificate. A certificate is valid for a value of time. Obviously, some certificates are known to be very long-lived and longly valued, like multiple years. The problem of this is when computational power becomes more, heavier, better, stronger, quantum crypto happens, these kinds of things, you would still have a valid certificate and no alarm bells would ring anywhere. Or you have a weak key. Somehow somebody figured out that if you use this algorithm with this key length or whatever, you are weakening your security. And this is why you have a validity date on this. And also just to renew, refresh, because sometimes people are careless about servers and they die off in a natural way. Typically they are valid for a year, sometimes 2 years, sometimes longer, depends. And there's a lot of other stuff on the certificate where we're going to eat, which we're going to tell about. So, who is this certificate from? Some certificates tell a lot of things. In this case, they even have an entire address book stuff into this. Street name, Mount Pliant 55, building number, room number, what? A bit too much. KPM BV, ITNL. There's a serial number in this part as well. It's a private organization. And this is how VeriSign, for instance, creates certificates and how it structures these kinds of high-quality certificates. It's with a lot of information. Why? Why would I want to have this type of information in my banking application or my website or kpn.com or whatever? Any takers?
The user,
yes, close.
Because he then knows that he's communicating with the right company.
Correct. You're talking to a company which is assigned, it's a signed statement, and somebody was willing to sign this statement, VeriSign or Semantic these days, with all these details. So one of the things that it tells you is that VeriSign took time to actually check the ownership details of the certificate to such a certain extent that they figured out this is the main building and the main office. Some certificates don't have this. So this means there's a little bit of a difference in trust level. This is also a certificate that creates this green bar, for instance. Anyway, it's about the user and it's about trust. All of this is about trust, trusting who you are communicating with. In this case, the certificate is signed by VeriSign and it tells you that it is. It also tells you for which class it is certified. They call this class 3. The important notice is the extended validation, which is the difference between a green padlock or a gray or blue padlock. Also costs you a lot more money. serial number. Each certificate has a unique serial number. It used to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you can enumerate all this. And you could see that some certificate vendors were more popular than others. They changed this for various reasons, and they made unique numbers out of this. Certificates that all have this not before and not after date in UTC. Time zones are, yeah, something that you should be wary about in security land. Always use and normalize on something, and one of the things certificates normalized on is UTC. Or if you dive down into OpenSSL source code, they call it Zulu time. Anybody? What's Zulu time? American, US, military? They had to name it themselves, so somehow they don't call it UTC or GMT, they call it Zulu time. Anyway, it means the same thing, so if you ever see UTC, GMT time, or Zulu, whatever, it means the same thing. You can normalize in this. This is important for logging and so on later, but this is a different topic. Anyway, I hope you all guys do forensics. Huh? Public key information, it tells you about what type of key is used. It tells you the modulus that was used, for instance, that we've seen in the examples. It tells you the public key. It also has the signature on the certificate. The usage. Can I sign another key with this one? Only an authority could sign another key, the other person's key, with respect to public key infrastructure. This is the difference between PGP, for instance, and this system. With PGP, it is the intent that everybody could sign everybody's key. Don't do this. Be cautious with respect to signing keys in PGP. There's a nice cartoon about that, but I should have used it. Anyway, key usage. Can I sign other certificates? Can I sign data? When do you sign data? If you have an HTTPS connection or a service, you sign data. You have the records that you send on the wire. This is the data you will send. You will sign because of the integrity control. CAs can sign CRL files. What this means, what a CRL is, I will dive into this later. But it's also some of those functionalities. It is stated if you are a authority or not. CA is yes or is true or false. It tells you something about the path length constraint. Path length constraint is, I believe I skipped this in my slides, but path length constraint is something, is a statement where you, it's a number and you can figure out, okay, that's too complex to explain now in the short way. Never mind, I will not bother you with that one, it would be too complicated. To tell you at slide number 39 just yet. Okay. After a while, there came new purposes for certificates. So there was a standard, and the standard got expanded into a new version of certificates. This happened somewhere in the 1990s, so you shouldn't really care about this, just assume this exists. You can specify if a certificate is used as a TLS client, a TLS server, or you can do email protection with this. This means signing and, in this case, encrypting email. This means software like Thunderbird, Outlook, whatever, or mail.app needs to know that you have this bit enabled, otherwise the certificate is not eligible for using in email encryption. Signing of code, this is an important detail these days, because I don't know if you use Java 1.7 and up, but it's these days it's mandatory to sign your code, otherwise it doesn't even execute. Or you have a very vulnerable system these days. Anybody still on Windows XP?
It's cool.
Yes? No targets today. Okay. Beautiful. Another thing is binding object hash to time. What? Yes, this is what I also have every time I see this. I have no idea what this means, but you can do it. Yes, okay. There's a thing in MTP, probably, in the MTP protocol that you can say I can give signed statements to this. This is only used, I believe, in Stratum 1 MTP systems, so this means somewhere near the atomic clock itself. But I've never seen an actual use for this. Another thing is signing OCSP responses, similar to CRLs, but slightly different. Also something very typical for only CAs. Another thing in certificates is the signing policy. I would call it the signing policy. It's actually called the CPS, or the certification practice statement. It's a URL, typically to a PDF. Some quote-unquote idiot CAs actually use a Word file in this, but okay. Typically it's a PDF file or a text file or another website which states why and how and for what purposes these certificates were signed. It tells you the policy at the moment of signing. Why is this important? Sometimes it's important to know that certificates can be exclusively used for web services. And this is the only thing that you can do with these types of certificates from this authority. Other policies would state, well, but this tree of certificates or CAs is only exclusively useful for email signing for human users. Sometimes it says in the certificate practice statement that a certificate that rolls out of the CA could be used for SSL interception. Yes, everybody awake? SSL interception, danger. It happens. There are on-site certificates, certificates distributed throughout the premise of an enterprise network, and which can be installed in your browsers, for instance, and can happen at for instance, at banking institutes or any other institutes where they have a strong incentive to inspect even the secured connections that go out of their offices. This is to protect the data of a company, for instance, and be able to inspect this. This is not a common practice, but it happens. It exists typically not on a public CA. This is by nature should never be a public CA, but only a private, internal company only CA. But there are companies that do this and make a statement about it. And you need to be very explicit why and how these certificates are used. It's about transparency. And sometimes it's fun to read those documents, sometimes it's not. Mostly not. Sometimes. There are CRL and OCSP endpoints, URLs. These are URLs where you fetch CRL files or interact with an OCSP server. This has to do with revocation. And here's an important detail. This is subject alternative names. Subject alternative names is the actual detailed structure where modern tools, modern being everything after May 2000, so this should be just regular tools these days. And they tell you about for which email addresses, could be multiple, is this certificate a valid certificate for? Could be mine, it could be any DNS name, so this would be for a web server. For which web service would it be valid? Like www.google.com, www.kpn.com, whatever. Could also be a statement for which IP address is this one valid. Which is an interesting one, because last week some of the software messed up this feature. Making it very easy to make a man-in-the-middle attack if people do not connect to host.example.org, but to its IP address. So if you would do HTTPS :// IP address, no checks would be done. Cute. This would be yes, easy to do man-in-the-middle attacks, for instance, and spoof around. And yeah, This was a problem mostly with back-end infrastructure, because nobody really serves to with an HTTPS connection on their web browser to an IP address. I know Chrome did it perfectly well. Firefox was also not vulnerable. Safari browser, I'm not really that sure about it. But there's more wrong with Safari these days. At least if you use a command line tool called curl. Does anybody know what the command line curl means and is? You use it. Or libcurl or pycurl. Python programmers. There's a lot of problems in that. Also, we use Python these days, and you don't take extra measures. You can be man in the middle pretty easily, actually. If you have a valid certificate from somewhere else, with a private key from somewhere else, you can just man in the middle of the traffic, and nobody will see that anything happens, because there's no error or warning. Some tools don't do all the SSL, TLS, handshake checks properly. And this is how you get pumped. Anyway, what kind of certificates do we end up with if we tick and tack the bits, flip it up and down? Okay, yes, it's for this or for that. And I signed it. Typically, you end up with something like you sign it for TLS www.server feature, and then you end up with an SSL certificate for websites and equal web services. This is the most common certificate that you see on the web. Any web site is using this type of certificate. If you use VPN solutions like IPsec tunnels and not TLS, SSL, VPNs, you might need a different type of certificate because some extra values need to be added for the IPsec installations to understand to which other party it needs to communicate. This also happens if you use a PKI infrastructure, which is pretty common actually, in a Microsoft environment. In domains, you also need to have build up a trust relationship between the domain nodes and the domain controllers. This happens with the technology of PKI behind the scenes. You don't really see it, but it happens. If you sniff the packets on Wireshark or something else, you will see what happens. What kind of SSL and TLS connections are made between the domain controllers. Other uses are personal company cards, for instance. Sometimes this golden chip here. Golden chips. This is just a normal contact chip. And in it, I have a crypto module which companies can give out. And these crypto modules is basically where my private keys are stored and my certificates. The only way of getting this out is scraping this off in an electron microscope environment. Some actually did. 2 years ago, five years ago. 5 years ago, Carsten Noll once did something similar to a MyFair classic chip. This is what basically boiled down to the MyFair debate about OV chip cards. So yes, you can do this, but it takes a lot of effort to do it. Without it, the private key will never, ever leave this chip. Except with my PIN. But then the private key is not ever surfaced from this device, always stay in it. The PIN codes only to unlock it, travel data through my chip, through my card reader, through this chip, sign data inside, so there's an actual crypto engine in this little device here. Actually, obviously, this is just protection for the NFC chip that's in it. So, This has an actual little computer chip in it that does crypto. A lot of companies have it these days to access VPNs or other resources. The PIN code is the thing that basically allows me to interact with the key, not get the key. which is an interesting tampering resistance thing these days. If you ever come about these kinds of technologies, this means somebody thought about the solutions. Another thing that you can do is code signing with certificates. This means this is a special purpose, and it's not that common these days, but people need to figure out how to do this in a bigger scale, because Java basically demands it these days. And there are other special purposes, some of them are classified. Requesting a certificate. What to put in a certificate? Signing request. If you want to have a certificate, you need to create a certificate signing request. It's a standard file, and what goes in is something that constructs the subject name, as you've seen this with the street name and so on. This name needs to follow a convention that is basically stated by the CA, because the CA says, yes, well, if you make this, you cannot just name it whatever you want. You have to follow our convention. You have to use a country code, you have to use an organizational unit, an organization statement, perhaps for the other, for extended validation certificates, you need to add a street address and so on. And especially for enterprises or any other firm that uses a bigger CA contract, they have to follow this, and because if you follow this, then you fall into the same contract and whatever. This just makes the life of the CA a lot easier. You have to publish the public key, the algorithm that is used, and you have to specify the subject alt names that you wish to be entered into the certificate. Sometimes if you cannot get this last step done, the CA can add this later. So, generating such a file basically means, or at least what you should do, is generate the keys on the target station. You can outsource this step. You can outsource a lot of steps. And you have to think about it. Think about what you're doing if the generation of the public and the private key would be outsourced. For example, if somebody would outsource it, the generation of your private and your public keys to VeriSign, DigiCert, Komodo, whatever, they love to help this. I love their help and support. But it's an American company. What happened last year? We had this Snowden thingy. Snowden happened. These days, it's for me a lot easier to explain, like, okay, well, you know what happened with Snowden, and they could actually ask for keys, and people could actually go to a certificate authority and retrieve the private keys that they hold in escrow for you. Escrow is a term that everybody knows, I hope. It means, how do you explain it? Escrow. Escrow. It basically means I have these keys and I set it into a vault, and the vault is managed by that was the English word for this.
Safekeeping.
Yeah, it's basically safekeeping as a service. So some banks do this. They can these days actually safekeep electronic goods as well as jewelry or whatever. So in this case, the keys to your kingdom can be set into a vault of somebody else. And there could be an FBI or subpoena statement to retrieve this data. What happens is that the private key, an authenticity, could be used into an attack against your organization. This is something you don't want, should not want. Hence, statement number one, generate the keys on your target station, and not on the premise of somebody else where you did not intend them to have administrative or opportunities for man-in-the-middling all your traffic. Forge the keys into a protective environment. think of software or hardware security modules. This is a bit double. Hardware security modules. Software or hardware security modules, also known as tokens. This thing can be regarded as a hardware security module. It's a tiny one, but it's not really useful for a service environment. There are better solutions for this with respect to tokens. Another solution would be if you have an SSL load balancer, for instance. They typically have something, a compartment, a specialized chip. These days, if you have an iPhone 5, 5S, only the 5S has the fingerprint reader, doesn't it?
Yes.
The 5S has an extra chip embedded into the system on chip solution, and this is where they have sort of like this escrow-like solution. This is where they store the keys, or at least the information for your fingerprints. Similarly, the private keys could be in enterprise solutions. They are similar chips, also very guarded, very well protected for physical attacks even, which can keep the private keys as private as possible. It's never a perfect world. Security is never perfect. But you can at least upgrade your security by doing so, instead of just a file system. Otherwise, take care of the file permissions before you actually generate this key on this. Use a true random generator. There are pseudo random generators. Don't use it. This is a true random generator. These days, slash dev urandom is typically used as an OpenSSL seeder for random generation. Latest word is that it's not safe enough. If you have the opportunity of waiting, use slash dev random, but you have to wait until there's sufficient entropy. Entropy, everybody knows what entropy is. Sufficient randomness. Random stuff. This is why on TrueCrypt, who uses TrueCrypt? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Everybody should use TrueCrypt. Anyway, TrueCrypt has a way of waiting for entropy, and basically this means wave your hand on all this and use your mouse as just waving. These days, if you have a smartphone, some of the crypto solutions use the tilt sensors as entropy. Because your movement now is slightly different than whatever somebody else would do. Very hard to replicate. Randomness is the core of generating a truly secure key. Somebody messed it up once. It's noted and registered in CVE 2008-0166. And this is the cartoon that came with it. People didn't seed this thing properly. The only thing that was used as the entropy for this was the PID of the system, of the program that was actually running it. PID, Linux, yes, everybody, the ones who are smiling already understand, but PID means process ID. On a Linux system at that time, process IDs can be up to 32,000. This means there are only 32,000, so 2 to the 17th? 15th. Something odd. Yes, you're right, it's 15. So 2 to the 15th options of having a random number. Oi, that's not much. Typically, you work in the order of millions. Millions of permutations for your private key. Suddenly, they fixed some compiler problem. The compiler complained, yes, your program is reading from uninitialized memory. Okay, let's fix it. Let's nullify everything. So null, put it on null, put it on null. Okay, good. And what happened is that the entire way of seeding your input data was now, unfortunately, only hinging on the PID number. While it should have been PID number plus a lot of other parameters for your seed input. Seed input is the input for your random function. Hence, don't fail to seed your random. The output of a certificate signing request file is a PKCS number 10 formatted file. It actually is called like this. PKCS number 7 is something else than a number 10 file. And it contains your request. This is signed with your private key, and this is the binding, one of those bindings between you, your request, and your request for the certificate, and thus something that we call proof of possession. This, people can challenge you on this and do a proof of possession check test. I sound like a broken record here, but protect the private key. Don't transfer the private key through email. Don't transfer this on another secured channel. Don't. Not even SSL can save you with the failures of actually messing up with this kind of things. And a technical detail is obviously encrypt the private key. Sometimes you have to transfer the private key, because you really have to do this on one system because somebody else can't, or the system, the target system cannot. Ways of doing this is to figuring out a way of actually encrypting the private key file properly. Perhaps use another encryption technique, like perhaps even send over TrueCrypt volumes where your private keys are stored in. This makes it really challenging, at least to decrypt. Depending on your target or your adversaries, you have to take a lot more care, obviously. Upload the PKCS 10 file to your RA, fill in a request form. I want a certificate, please. I'm Oscar, yay, I want one. Give my certificate. You upload the file, you wait for approval. Download the certificate.
Approval, is that, is it? When you are played.
Yes. So there's obviously intermediate waiting for approval would be money transfer. Certificates cost money typically, because people have to do something for you to get one. There are some services you have to look for them. Start conferences, Start SSL. They have the first one is free. Like other means, like getting hooked on drugs or something, but the first one is always free. That's what they also roll with. But yes, payment money, part of an MPKI environment, a managed PKI environment. So this means if you have a big enough company, hey, you can have one organization or part of the organization that is controlling all the requests before they send it through, and they figure out which other department to bill, or have some other choice to make. Only when they approve, the certificate goes through to the CA, they arrange it, they get the certificate input, they sign it, send it back, and this party in between, from the MPKI environment, can push it to the actual administrator of the machine. This is how big companies have no direct contact to a CA, but always an intermediate person that vouches for you. CAs, do we want to take a short break? Or can we continue?
Dat is half de GA. Dat is de deur. Dat is de deur.
Ik zal even de time sync, even de sound sync doen weer. Dat kan ik zelf doen trouwens. Gewoon. Ja, dat kan.
Yes. You continue.
The stick of truth.
Do we continue? CAs. They should have made this a tagline for any CA, which is something like, indeed, what Cartman would always say in that particular episode. First season, Pac-Man Thought Tank. So, you contact the CA. So what happens on the other end is you enter your certificate signing request and you give it to a registration authority. Registration authority is something that you could see as the portal, a front page, a intermediate person or company between an actual CA and his own little business, or the MPKI environment that I explained for enterprise solutions, for instance. Those can be stated as a registration authority. They check the binding between the request, the requester, and the actual entity for which it is vouching a certificate for. This is then, as Rob already mentioned, is obviously checked with credit card information if you would actually if you actually paid, but also that it is you who paid for this certificate. Some CAs really check who is the owner of the credit card, and that is the only person that could actually get a hold of the certificate, for instance. In some cases, personal identification needs to be transferred. For instance, if you have a Tirina certificate, which is something in the SurfNet environment, if you are a researcher, I see one hand going up, and my hand is going down because I don't have one anymore, but I used to. It means there is a process combined with your HR department, human resources department, that will be able to tie you, your request, your entity, to your identifying material. Could be your passport that you had to show somewhere, somehow in the process of your employment. This information can be linked to get you a certificate or not. Obviously, for websites, DNS record information will be checked if you actually own the DNS. Sometimes if you register a host name or a subdomain, the actual domain underneath this one needs to be checked as well. If you are actually the owner, the full owner of the entire domain name. The IP info, this means go to VIPE and the VIPE database and figure out if you are the owner of the IP net block. If you are not, then you might not get the information. Or there needs to be a tie between what is in the WHOIS database, the VIPE database, and the IP address that it will be vouching for. Another thing would actually be an in-person check. There are environments, government environments, where a personal identification process needs to be taking place when you actually need to be there in person at least once to figure out who you are. Who is the guy behind the signed email, for instance? Guy, girl, whatever. That is an in-person check. It all depends on the circumstances and the environment and use case. The CA receives the CSR from the RA. Administrative steps aside, obviously they make records of everything they sign. They create a certificate from the CSR file by constructing an X509 construct, as we've seen in the beginning. And they sign this piece of data with the private key, so that no changes can be performed on this certificate and on this data that they bring out. And the signature is of this CA. This is something you can do when you're on the command line, just for fun and games, or in a little tool. But in enterprise environments, they use these kinds of devices. These are tamper-proof devices. And this is a FIPS 140 level 4 certified device, where you this basically means it's tamper-proof. Even if you use a drill or whatever, you shouldn't be able to lift it and open it. Even on the side, you can see these rosters for air cooling. They need to be blinded so that you cannot view, take a side view of the electronics. This is for FIPS level, FIPS 140 level 2 certification. And then you have multiple cryptographic keys to authenticate yourself into this device with PIN codes to just work on this and do your thing. This is basically what it brings you up to level 4, which means there's not just one cryptographic method of working with this device, but that there are multiple stages or levels of certification for the operators as well. Pretty expensive hardware. The private key of the CA is in here. Stamper proof, cannot be brought out. CA has built a million-dollar business. Can anybody tell me why a CA would buy multiple of these devices? Why would all CAs at least have two of these boxes?
Backup.
Why?
What if one device fails?
What if one device fails? Yes. Your million-dollar business just went kaput with this device. This is why they always have two, typically on one location, and at least a spare or another solution elsewhere. So typically they buy a few of these boxes. So in that sense, SafeNet is doing a very good business on that. Well, there's Thales and other companies that make the same kind of product, typically labeled with Cisco, HP, whatever. So, but it's actually always there are only a few companies in the world that actually make this stuff. Funny enough, most of them have their tech departments in Israel. Mm-hmm. Little thing on the side. Okay, CAs. The CAs are for it. CAs can overrule CSR information. So you wished that you got all these subject alternative names. You wished for this subject name to be formed like this and this. You wanted this MD5 hash algorithm to appear in your certificate. The CA can say, no. We're going to use something more protective here. You're going to use my template. My template is authority. There's always a Cartman behind the scenes. So they follow the template. They match it with the current policy depicted in the certificate practice statement. They select the hash algorithm used, MD5, I put it up for fun. MD5 is these days, it's a bit of a joke, especially in crypto, nobody really uses it. At least not for these purposes anymore. It's a perfectly nice hash algorithm, but not really good enough for this, because there have actually been attacks. It was the, was it Flame? Can't remember. There was a Flame attack, if I'm not mistaken, it was Flame or another one. Boils down to a Microsoft terminal server certificate, and this was used for software update man in the middle. So there was a situation where a certificate was forged in such a way that some characteristics of the certificate file were the same, the effective hash was the same as was different, but resulted in the checks and how the code checks these verifications was an equal outcome. The file was completely changed, and there was another private key used, obviously forged by the attackers. And this is how people had the problem of all their software updates from Microsoft being interceptable and man in the middle of all. Interesting attack, because it was one of the first attacks ever, which was only theorized at the time. And nobody figured out if either a nation state adversary or a big, huge mob, mafia kind of institution, you could actually call it these days, was behind this attack of getting malware installed on hosts as it was legitimate software. Because all the signatures that boiled down from this software update mechanism were all legitimate, and the system couldn't figure out if your Windows system couldn't figure out if there was anything wrong with this installation, with the software. A really sophisticated hack, because it probably used the attackers, and they probably needed a pretty darn big computer infrastructure to crack it and to make it happen. Anyway, so MD5 was used in that attack, or compromised, in a practical way. These days, SHA-1 is also up for debate. It's currently the most used hash algorithm. Look at the PKI overheid of the Dutch government. This is exclusively using SHA-2. Except for acceptable situations where they need to migrate to SHA-2 soon. But sometimes, if you have appliances that cannot deal with modern current day technology or algorithms, you really need to have a certificate still to be able to do your work today with SHA-1 at least. People are moving to SHA-2, it's a slow process. In a few years, 2015 or 16, I always swap it around. Either 2015, the world will probably take up SHA-2 as the new standard. And if I'm not mistaken, 2016, Microsoft will disallow the use of MD5 and SHA-1 on their domain controller infrastructure. So this means if you use these kinds of certificates in your Windows domain, stuff will stop. If you have a big enterprise, hey, it means work. But it's not 2016 yet, and if you just update to a slightly recent, more recent Windows Server environment, you're basically done and settled already. So if you still are on Windows Server 2003 systems and Windows XP, this is going to be a problem. Not just for your security, but just that stuff might not work suddenly. All boils down to these kinds of practices. So, root CAs and subordinate CAs. CAs come in different levels. CAs work in different ways as well. And there's this root CA. These are the ones that are installed on your laptops, on my phone, on all kinds of set-top boxes, perhaps, in my TV even. I've got a Samsung Smart TV, and I've noticed on the open source legal stuff that Samsung is using a lot of interesting, funny tools that I use on my laptop as well. And they also install root CAs there. It's for the secure communication to sites. If you have a TV or anything else with a web browser on board, you have these installed of most of the most common publicly available CAs. Then there are intermediate CAs, issuing CAs, and the actual entity CA certificates. The entity certificates, I use the term entity because if you ever would walk through a RFC, a description on how this the spec works. It will always denote a certificate that is for a person, a user, designing the actual crypto work that you want to do. Always be named as an entity certificate.
Maybe you can mention the path length thing now.
Yes.
You skipped over it earlier.
An issuing CA, a good issuing CA, because not all issuing CAs are good, or use this in practice. They set a path length constraint. Path length constraint of typically a value of zero. What does this mean? If the issuing CA mentions and states a path length constraint of zero, it means no other CA will be signed between here and here. This means that if an intermediate CA would state a path length constraint of one, then one CA can be issued underneath this one, but no other again. This detail is important in, to know and understand for one of the cases at the end. Just a hint, it's about DigiNota. So, typically issuing CAs have a path length constraint of zero. No other CA could be created from this CA anymore. And this one signed for that certificate of that issuing CA. So it's hard-coded, it's wired, you can make no changes of this anymore. Browsers will check this. Browsers will check path length constraint. They will have a look at all these verification steps. And if one of these CAs have a path length constraint number to it, it will check that this chain would not be extended with another intermediate CA or subordinate CA. Anyway, so there's a root CA, there's typically an intermediate CA, an issuing CA that actually gives out the certificates for normal use, for host certificates, personal certificates, whatever. Typically, this infrastructure is a bit of a more complex hierarchy, because in some, these intermediate CAs could be used for a government, could be used for instance, the government of Belgium uses Komodo, if I'm not mistaken, these days still Komodo. So they have a root CA of Komodo, they have their own CA, and then they have their CA for their PKI government hosts, personal certificates, other purposes, whatever. This is how you can scope this stuff. So if they don't pay their money, the root CA can issue a statement, this intermediate CA is not valid anymore, they didn't pay, they have to stop, whatever. And well, this is what Komodo has as power over the government in Belgium. In the Netherlands, we have our own root CA. This means we are, well, authoritative to ourselves. That sounds funny, but anyway. We are authoritative and we have intermediate CAs, and this is what you see for certificates for this DGD infrastructure, certificates for e-herkenning, certificates for medical use, like for the medical readers that your doctor could have at home, at his office. What's it called? NICTIS is making this stuff. Their crypto cards basically means they are part of the APD system, which is not called an APD system because that's not allowed anymore, but something else similar to EPD. Anyway, this is how they structure it and how they use it. So different companies, different use cases, different users, different policies. Motivations for these sub-CAs, besides compartmentalizing this by purpose, is that you only need to distribute the root CAs and the sub-CAs. Some sub-CAs can be distributed, mostly they are not. Only the root CAs are distributed, and they are distributed everywhere. Embedded devices, Linux, Windows, OS X, any type of BSD system, Firefox, they come with Firefox, Opera, software update tools, Windows tools, separate tools might actually bring their own stack of root CAs again, everywhere. And there is an opportunity to state, I'm going to revoke this chunk. Sipsiates, you just saw there could be a huge hierarchy. Why are only rootsiates installed on my laptop? It's because, and this is one of those installation, typical installation failures and mistakes. If you run your own website, who has a website? Who has some blog or whatever website for their own? I expect more. Okay, well, at least a few. What you have to do is you don't just install this host certificate file. You have to install a file which contains the host certificate and typically also all the intermediate certificates for the CAs. So what happens is if you set up a connection, it will push through the connection your certificate, a certificate for all the intermediate subordinate CAs, and then ultimately the root CA is what is installed as your trust anchor in your browser. And with this, it will complete the entire chain from root, CA, intermediates, up to the final certificate. So that you can make a complete trust path and check all the certificates signing signatures. If you come across a root CA being transported as well into the SSL handshake, you have to ignore it. It's part of the protocol, because otherwise somebody else could give you a root CA like, trust me, I'm totally legit. Here's my CA certificate. Look, this certificate is completely valid with myself. This is not how it works. You always, all the SSL implementations chuck the root CA, they move it aside, and they only use the installed, trusted, pre-trusted certificates. Mozilla, Microsoft, Opera, you name it. All the companies that are known to have their own root CAs installed and distributed, they check for the good operational practices of all the CAs in there. If you see 100 root CAs, each of them have followed procedure, each of them are checked time-wise again for their operational practices, if they have their private keys installed in a tamper-proof system, in a safe, which should be placed in a safe or bunker. Access control to the CA is checked and verified, and this is what all the, this is how you have this trust relationship. You don't just trust the root CA, you trust Mozilla doing all this checking. You trust Opera or Microsoft to have a team that checks all these root CAs. In, if I'm not mistaken, this is Chrome. You can see the difference in coloring. This is the certificate that's now being where I now connect to for the host. This is the intermediate certificate, and this is the root certificate. This one is pre-installed, and this is what you can see at least on my Mac, on my Chrome Mac. I think it's the same in Windows or Linux. You can see that it is stated as orange to be the installed root CA. Sometimes it happens that two levels might be orange. This means the sub CA is installed and pre-installed as well. It's not common, but it happens sometimes. And with the blue symbol, it means this is what you got over the wire. This is what you received. Certificate revocation list and online certificate status protocol, also part of this entire spec, also known as CRLs and OCSB. It's a revocation list with serial numbers signed by the CA. CRLs are time limited, typically valid for 2 weeks. And they look like this. Here's an old example. Wow, 2012. Okay. What you can see here is that it is the Quo Vadis Limited Certificate Authority for GRID computing systems. And this one tells you also why, gives a motivation, why a certificate was, the serial number of a certificate was set on the CRL file. In this, if for the people in the back, it stated here key compromise. Key compromise. What does a key compromise mean?
Stolen.
Any other options?
Yeah.
Could also mean somebody goofed up. If you install it on a networked shared device and another administrator figures out you put it on an NFS share and it was world readable, the private key for instance, that means your key was compromised. No attacker was involved here, but the core principle is, how do you know? You can't really, especially if you put this file up for world readability. So it might be more interesting to figure out on what this exactly means, but in this case key compromise could mean a lot of things. Could mean a failure, could mean the owner of the certificate just put in the into a radio box like, okay, well, this was the reason why I wanted a new certificate. It was still valid, but I want to revoke it. Key compromise. Another reason would be superseded. I got a new one because I lost my keys, or I lost the PIN code, or I lost something, so I couldn't access my key anymore. Superseded. This is a signed statement and published for everybody to see, typically not with these reasons, because some people figure out this is, it might be a privacy issue. OCSP works completely different, but serves the similar purpose. A CRL is typically a file from 60 kilobytes, 100 kilobytes, 150 kilobytes, could be bigger, could be smaller. And typically these are refreshed by their validity time. If the validity time is 2 weeks, your browser will not download a new one if the other one was still valid. So you could be compromised for about 2 weeks' time, at maximum, because a hacker came into some website, stole the private key, somebody figured it out, published it to the CA, and said, hey, my key was compromised, hacker, complicated, whatever, revoke it. Your browser will only renew the CRL file if you enforce it to do so, or if your CRL validity time is over, which could take up to 2 weeks. Or a month if you have a lazy CA. OCSP is a client-server protocol where a direct connection, a direct link, a query can be issued to this OCSP server. There are two RFCs involved. Online Certificate Status Protocol, so the protocol for this stuff, or the lightweight, high-volume environment specification. Funny enough, if people use Nginx, for instance, and you use features like OCSP stapling, blah, 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 and you read the code, you have nothing to do, you read the code. You figure out that people just mixed and matched the RFCs because they didn't know how the hell to use it. This happens too. SSL, the technology itself, is a bit on the complicated side. People should make this a lot more easier to use than currently is, but unfortunately, we're in the situation right now. What do you, how would you care? Well, you don't. In this case, the CAs just need to compromise on their OCSP services, like, okay, fact of life, people don't read this specification properly enough, and now we have to do both, including the mixing and matching of varieties between the protocol specifications. Anyway, a request. You send a certificate CRL number to an OCSP service, and the responder responds with a signed message. Messages could be something like good, revoked, unknown, and, because of reasons. Not always the reasons are specified, but you typically you have something like unspecified, key compromise, CA compromise. CA compromise means very sign got hacked. This means the whole dark internet is insecure now. If you see this, run. Affiliation changed, I moved to another company or whatever happened. Superseded, cessation of operation. Cessation of operation. This has nothing to do with bearing and birthing a baby or something like that, having a cessation or cessation. It basically means if you have a CA and a sub-CA, gets removed and cut from this hierarchy, typically you would have a cessation of operation notice. Very rare, sometimes they don't even bother to call it that way. Certificate on hold, this basically means you didn't pay, probably. At least some CAs use it as you didn't pay. And you're on hold for now. Or it's removed from CIRA, but it depends on operation. Okay. Breathing moment. Now we're gonna have a slightly deeper look into TLS.
Slightly deeper, man. Mm-hmm.
Bear with me. So, you have this connection, stateful connection being set up, GCP, IP, or TCP, UDP, and you have a connection. Over this connection, you have to set up this TLS handshake with the TLS handshake protocol. And then, within the TLS, after that stage, you have the application data that can pass through securely. And within that, encapsulated, you have HTTP or any other thing you're doing there. So, these are the messages that go, or can go through, from left to right, from right to left. So, first thing that happens is you have the server hello, or the client hello. Hello.
Hi.
And then it answers, hello. TLS is such a friendly. Anyway, there are some capabilities of the clients stated in this client hello. Like, which algorithms can I support? We need to decide on an algorithm. Because, yeah, you use OpenSSL, I use GNU TLS, somebody else uses PolarSSL, somebody else has an embedded device with a hardware solution. And they might not support all the protocols that you can think of. You wish they do, but they don't. Practical situations. So, between the client hello and the server hello, there's a conversation going. You state all your capabilities. The server figures out, okay, I have my list of capabilities with the paper cipher suites. We will mediate on the strongest one and start a conversation. And start our other messages for the handshake to actually set up a secured session. So this is what happens between the client hello and the server hello. The server also pushes its certificate. This includes the subordinate certificates if so configured. If so configured, because sometimes it is not configured as such, and then you might end up with a protocol breakage, or you just don't use subordinate CAs. That's also a valid opportunity. Something modern and new is this certificate status OCSP stapling thing. What does this mean? I call this the privacy solution in this sense. Later in the DigiNotar case study thingy, I will get to this, but even more. Because the thing is, if your certificate status is retrieved from with a client-server protocol, OCSP, you connect to this OCSP server of the CA. What do you send? You send a serial number. What does the CA know? The CA knows this certificate is valid for this particular site. This could be a web shop. This could be something that your mother shouldn't know that you were looking at. The CA knows in that sense that A, you are secured and have you have a secure payment thing going on between this site as well. But the CA knows where you were surfing to. OCSP stapling means that this site downloads the OCSP statement, the signed statement of the CA, downloads it, caches it there. So yes, they could tamper with the caching, but the OCSP statements are short-lived. They can only live for a few hours maximum. They download it and they can send it through. This means if you set up a connection, to the server, and the server answers with an OCSP stapled statement. Nobody else but the server knows that you were him. No CA knows about a query for your own safety to happen in the background. It's a bit of privacy. If you have a certain selection of cipher suites, certain selections of cipher suites need the server to take a first step into setting up something else for the encryption. What do I mean by this? If you have a Diffie-Hellman, an ephemeral Diffie-Hellman key exchange, for instance, instead of a normal SSL handshake, the server needs to take an extra step, and the server needs to initiate and can specify and state by this message, I'm going to use a different key for my session keys, and it's not going to be bound to my certificate. Typically, servers bind their SSL handshake and their encryption keys to their certificate keys. You can make a different step. Optionally, so this is what the star option is, optional, these are all optional. Optionally, a server can also request for a client certificate. Servers can post certificates, but a client can also be requested to send his certificate. Example would be my company card, for instance, and a VPN. This is where my client certificate would be pushed to the server. A client key exchange can happen, and this is also to state I'm going to do something with the keys for the actual encipherment of the SSL session. It can be a certificate verification step. This is combined with the client certificate step. Both the server and the client acknowledge that they changed the cipher specification from whatever they were starting to do, like RSA with RSA keys. They change to the session keys that they're going to use, the AES keys, and that they start an encrypted handshake. Optionally, server can also give you a session ticket, or session ID or ticket. This means if you go back to the server again later for a second connection, you can, in the client hello, you can specify, hey, I've already seen you, we already exchanged authentication thingies. I can just send you a signed statement, and then we can resume our session faster. We don't have to do this entire authentication step again. Both acknowledge the encrypted handshake, server and client state, we're done. Server name initiated. Who knows what virtual hosts are? A few hands, pretty good. Does anybody know how to configure those stuff? Two hands less.
How is this possible? You've all done this in your very first year.
You failed.
Sorry, Oscar has spoken.
Anyway, now you have a green fail because this is where. So let's. If you have an HTTP server, you have one IP, but it can host for many domain names. This is the virtual hosting stuff. You have one IP, one server, and the HTTP header host colon. And a name is what Apache, Nginx, Comanche, just name a few of these things, can use to say, okay, you'll need to get this home page, you'll need to get this landing page, this index.html file, whatever. This is the virtual hosting method. Problem is, if you look at this diagram, well, the other. The not Oscar winner again. If you look at this, HTTP is encapsulated in TLS. How do you exercise this entire mechanism for virtual hosting if you're not even communicating HTTP just yet? Which server certificate should you give? With whom are you actually talking to? What domain are you serving now? Virtual hosting for HTTP is long understood. The problem is there can only be one TLS, TCP/IP handshake here to one IP address, and then it starts a TLS handshake. And you don't know for which domain it is. This concludes one, that you can only use one certificate for one IP address. In the hosting environment, that didn't really fly. Because they say, well, sometimes we have virtual hosting here. We serve about 1,000 web pages per IP address because we have a big load balancer, and we have one IP address, and we have endless users and communities that we serve. We cannot serve you with SSL. Well, there goes security on the internet. Yeah? And they before the adoption of SNI, server name initiator, there was no solution. Internet Explorer 6 does not, this is even before Windows XP. Before Internet Explorer 6 started in Windows 2000, even Windows 98, second edition if I'm not mistaken. Ancient. It did not understand SNI, didn't support it. Server name initiator is sent in the client hello. Not all clients sent this initially. It implements virtual hosting for SSL. And there's only one way to make this really clear on how this works. Short demo. Flies, multiple windows and so on. Looks like this shell. So, I has connection. It's even alive. Let's, for instance, go to. So I've made this tool called. Can you see this in the back, though? Mm-hmm. Yes. No. Oh. Yeah. Look. Solved all the problems here. If I go to my page, don't mind the SSL error. This is because I didn't specify which CAs and root CAs I need to verify with. Could actually fix that, but I'm lazy. The thing is, I went to the host. OscarKubo.net without SNI. This means there's no specification on which virtual host I should go to. I use Nginx and I've configured it to go to default web pages or to this. So if I indicate SNI, look up, I see you actually get a different certificate. This one is from Startcom. And this was my own floppy duppy thingy. If we Wireshark this, let's shark it. That other screen. If the other screen is going to just hook up.
Narrow display.
Yeah. Thing is, it's stuck now. Where is my screen? crashed.
And
it's gone. Oh, maybe not. It's just invisible. Well, people can say Max do everything right, but they can also just mess up.
Denied.
Mimi.
Even pauze?
Oh, shut up.
Yeah.
Go there.
Yes.
Start. Vlag. Yes, come on. I'm just doing DNS. Come on. On the screen. Mavericks. Nice demo effect. Ah, yes. Well, okay. So, boils down to the fact that my Google is faster than my phone in DNS. Good skits. So if I run the command again, oh my goodness, let me see everything. Look, client hello, this is important. So the client hello, la la la, 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 la. Blah blah blah, random, what time is it on my laptop? Ah, sometime. It has no server name initiative on this. While if I change it, this is of course Blackmagic movie work now because you can't see what I'm typing over here. Second session. Looking for the hellos. So this is the first client hello. Here's the other client hello. Hello. Server name. Whoa, what is this? Server name initiator. Host name.
So basically the same monster with the SNI flag.
Yes, it's the same. But in this case, we now have an extra block with an extra TLS extension with server name in this length, and this is how it is composed, and it's called Ostrich. Now the server knows what type of certificate it needs to answer, because I've scoped everything to these virtual names, both on HTTP and HTTPS with the SSL stuff. Nginx does this pretty easily, these days Apache as well. And this is the prime difference. This is how you figure out, okay, you make a TCP/IP connection, now you set up an SSL session, and the server can now host endless amounts of virtual hosts again with SSL, and each could have their own certificate. Each can have their own certificate, because if I well, you already saw the demo. You saw with my name, if I change the I've got about three certificates, like, okay, bogus, wild, and an actual one for my actual website. So far this part. So, this is server name initiator. This is how virtual hosting works in the real world with SSL these days. This is an example of yet another example of an handshake. What you see here as well is that there are In this case, it states for this message this in Handshake Protocol client hello message. It specifies which version of TLS my client can understand as the best version that I have. If my client could understand TLS 1.2, it would indicate I can do 1.2. You can downscale me, but I do 1.2. In this case, it states TLS 1.0. This also indicates what the options are with respect to encryption cipher suites, encryption options. This is a list of the encryption algorithms that I support. This is everything from TLS, Hip-to-Curve, Diffie-Hellman, Ephemeral, RSA with AES, encryption, 256, blah blah blah, CPC, SHA, and worse. Including a lot of other parameters and a bit of randomness, random bytes sent, including the time. This is sent to the server. Server responds with a server hello. Formalizes the fact that we're going to talk TLS 1.0. Also, the server gives out his random, a bit of random. This is used in the entire key exchange and part of the encryption algorithms to use. The cipher suite of choice for this encryption is TLS RSA with RC4 128 bytes with MD5. Shiver me timbers, this is not the best cipher suite that you could choose. There are quite some interesting flaws these days with this combination, but okay, still very hard to crack in practice. But this is not the only message that was sent from the server that fitted more. A certificate was also sent. In this case, you can see that the certificate for www.kpn.com is sent with a VeriSign Class 3 Extended Validation SSL certificate and a public primary certificate. So this is a root certificate. So it also sends a root certificate. All the clients need to ignore this. And then also it states, well, server hello is done. We're done with hello. Hello is fun. Not anymore. Ha. Client answers with the other important things, which are client key exchange. In this message, you see the encrypted pre-master key. Encrypted pre-master key. This is the root, or actually the beginning of how the clients and the servers negotiate their session keys. So you've got keys all around. You've got the private key, public key, certificates, blah blah blah. But you have this is for asymmetric cryptography, which is very slow and computationally intensive. It's why they use AES or other encryptions. It's to enhance performance essentially and still be encrypted, but it uses a symmetric key. This means a shared key between the client and the server to understand this negotiation, or at least this conversation. And the root of this in the cipher suite that we just see with RC4 and RSA is the pre-master key, which is sent here. There's an extra computational step being done on the client and on the server to get to the master keys, which then steps to the session keys. But this is sent off. It's encrypted with the public key of the server. It specifies, okay, we're going to change cipher spec. We're going to do TLS 1.0. You already have all the data on what we're going to talk about. So this is my indication. From here on, we're going to not talk with our handshake protocol. We're going to use encrypted messages. And the already attached sub-message already is an encrypted handshake message. So, that's the weakest link here. This is our normal SSL TLS handshake that we have today when we talk to our bank. Maybe not all the banks, but at least some do. Some have this. RC4 is very powerful, AES as well. I mean, there are all kinds of advantages for this encryption, but it lacks one little problem. Session keys are derived from the pre-master keys. Pre-master key is generated by the client and then encrypted, sent to the server. The client encrypts it with the server's public key. Client and server both generate the master key, and from this the session key for read and write. Conclusion: exposing the private key of the server will allow decryption of all encrypted traffic that ever passed by this node. Ever.
What?
Does anybody know about LavaBit? LavaBit got stopped as a company on June 6th last year. What happened on June 6th last year? The FBI came to LavaBit and said, yo, hey man, you want your private key? Now I'm going to give you my private key. Yes, you do. Signed by the judge. So, LavaBit said, well, hell no. I know how this SSL thingy works. You're not going to get my private key. They said, yeah, you have to. So, LavaBit decided to do the non-obvious, and they had to give it up. Otherwise, the guy from LavaBit would be, I think he got a $10,000 or even more per day for not obliging to this request. So, essentially, he said, okay, well, the hell with this, I'm gonna stop serving LavaBit because, well, everything is compromised. Now, how did he give out the private key? He printed it on a font size 4, encoded in, I think he used ASCII or something really hideous, in a very odd, tightly Roman thingy. He made it horrible for them to OCR the private key, but he gave the private key. So he was, he did his bit on just pestering about FBI. Now, why did he do this? LavaBit was a mail service used by this guy. So, Eddie here, he used this service. Anyone, the FBI, well, probably some other service, but they asked the FBI to come get all this stuff. The other service called the NSA or something. Man. What's in the name these days? They asked for the private key. And because of this pre-master key generation and how this is communicated over from the client and how this is negotiated, it is encrypted with the public key. The server's private key will decrypt the pre-master key, and then a well-known mechanism will work. And if you captured the entire SSL handshake, TLS handshake, if you captured the TLS handshake, and then you captured the entire traffic, and then you combine it with the private key, you're done. You can decrypt not just his email, you can decrypt every communication that ever happened in the past and in the future to this server from everybody, because it was the server's private key. Everybody communicated with that server's private key. So the server's private key was valid for typically how long?
2 years.
And so all the communication for those types of years could be decrypted just for the fun of it. Well, they needed to find this terrorist. There's a solution to this. It's called perfect forward secrecy. Perfect forward secrecy can be achieved by ephemeral Diffie-Hellman, also known as ephemeral or EDH or DHE or sometimes you can see EC for this, EC for elliptic curve, Diffie-Hellman ephemeral. And ephemeral things means, it's from Greek, it means something like lasting only one day. In crypto, they actually mean very short-lived keys or only valid for this communication or not even known to this. They call it the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. I do want to note that some cryptographer called Merkle also had to do something with it. Merkle. Anybody knows Merkle? Nobody knows Merkle, but Arnhem maybe. Arnhem, do you know Merkle as a cryptographer? And what is his greatest achievement?
No, sorry.
Does anybody use BitTorrent or Bitcoin? Thank this guy. He's probably dead, I'm not sure. But he actually came up with work that had to do with signed hash chains, chaining hash algorithms. This is used in the distribution mechanism for torrent files and how to distribute files equally over the entire network, but still keeping sufficient hash information so that each of the chunks that you move around in the network are A, linked together as one file, B, that, so again, cryptography for just your well, let's call it Pirate Bay thingies, and just having your file integrity in place. So it's file integrity and part of file's integrity and still being linked together. Same mechanism holds for Bitcoins. It's again a crypto party thingy. Bitcoins. It's because all the chains, all the movements through the network of Bitcoins are linked together in Merkle trees. And, well, similar mechanism is used here to do a key exchange. So it's mostly work from Merkle that was used by Diffie and Hellman, two guys, two learners. Both are still alive. To add this key exchange. The public key and the private key of the server are only used for authentication. They are only used as a method of figuring out that a piece of information for the Diffie-Hellman key exchange is authenticated and authentic. That it actually came from the client and from the server. Nothing else. It's not like the other example, completely linked and tied to the private key. It's decoupled. The session keys are explicitly not derived from the information from the certificate. There's an extra step. Let's go painting. Back to kindergarten. Under the assumption that if we mix colors, color separation the other way doesn't really work that well. If I mix it up and I make brown, which colors did I actually use to make this particular flavor of brown? You can't really figure this out. It's the same kind of deal with this. You have a common paint, yellow, you take your secret keys, secret colors, you mix them up, you come to a conclusion of mixed information, you move it to the other side, and with the secret colors you can actually have derive a common secret. Let's take this as an example. So in calculation you have this base value and you've got this generator, what they call it. It's modulus in the other encryption algorithm. It's the same kind of key. You have a private key, 15, and you calculate this from this common known information, the public key, 6. So Eve, the adversary, the NSA, whoever, knows about 6. They also know about 3 and 17 as part of the equation. The private keys, 13 and 15, are never communicated over the wire. But you can communicate them, so you can raise them, the public key to the power of, I mean not the exponent of the other one, the power of 15. You come to the conclusion that you can have 10 as your shared key by these two public and private keys. So Eve only knows about these numbers 6, 12, mod 17, and 3. And the idea is that if you have only the public information of these keys, that the equations are similarly the same. This goes too fast to explain it in English as well. Anyway, there's a bigger movie which is cute to watch. I will publish this PDFs at least to Arnhem so you can get the full movie of 5 minutes. But at least the gist of it is that you have this mechanism going on. And that Eve is in no way with the public information capable of deriving the shared key. So Eve is still busy on discrete logarithmic problems, which means just brute forcing all the combinations. And if you use this mechanism with big enough numbers, it becomes really hard to brute force all the potential possibilities and permutations of the two numbers that you need for this communication. And this is the server key exchange mechanism. And if we go about the same set of Wireshark things again, we can see a client hello now with TLS 1.2, but with TLS 1.0 it would also work. But this is what this client is negotiating. It negotiates a lot of options with respect to cipher suites. They come to the conclusion that they're going to use TLS, elliptic curve, Diffie-Hellman ephemeral, the good ones, with an RSA public key, and they use AES as the actual session encryption, CBC for the change block cipher, and they use SHA-384 for the integrity control. The certificate is passed from the server. In this case, it's from another site. And this is where you have the server key exchange. Notice that that Wireshark doesn't understand the values P and Q in the equation and filter that nicely out and display it nicely. But you can see here the server key exchange. It has a length of 585 bytes of where you have on one hand the modulus, so the generator, the right side of the mod, and the base value. And it also serves the public key of the server. Client answers with his set of client parameters. They already negotiated the base, they already negotiated the generator. It pushes his P and Q values, and yes, we can now have a conversation that is solely purpose. So now, from this, another message happens, of course, and I didn't display this. Sorry. But basically, the only thing that happens after this one is from these shared secrets, they can derive the session keys. So the shared secrets that they now have, the server and the client, this is what generates the new session keys. Notice the difference that nowhere this master key that will be generated in the next packet is not derived at least from the private key. So if the NSA comes barging in, which might actually happen today, at least we know, FBI could actually do this work for them, they can come ask the server key, and all the communications that would happen before the time of stealing the server, yeah, all the keys are ephemeral. All these keys will disappear. These keys that were just negotiated were only valid for this session. If you cut the session, keys are gone. Keys are gone means you cannot decrypt it unless you completely brute force it. So it's not the case anymore like with LavaBit, you compromise the private key and you can decrypt everything just because you have the data. So this makes it, so Dragnet surveillance options are basically not an option anymore with this. yes, you can still hack it, yes, you can still brute force the entire thing, as long as you have sufficient budget, which some agencies at least have, you can crack it somewhere in Utah. For those who know, building up a nice little data center in Utah. Yeah, there are some products out there that actually use it. One of them is, for instance, the Whisper Systems TechSecure. Another one is Silent Circle, who has silent text, silent phone. And there are various, there's Redphone, also from Whisper Systems, which use at least the same key exchange. And there are a lot of banking sites who move over to this system as well, and to this method as well, exclusively. Because it just say, yeah, it's for the trust and for the security of their clients, this is the most viable, simplest solution. Okay, certificate checking. How do we check the certificate? Not sure if the certificate is legit. Okay. There are differences between the protocols, because okay, we know about these certificates now, we know about these TLS handshake thingies, but who the hell am I talking to? And how do I know? How do I know this is not intercepted, man in the middle or someone? So there's this RFC 2818, XP over TLS. The goal is to bind this certificate information that we just verified, because we now know how to verify all these things. And we have a secure connection. Now how do we tie this all up? How do we know we're still not intercepted? The important step, or at least thing to set up, is of course you have the TCP/IP handshake, and you have to remember the URL you went to. Seems simple. www.example.org or some other company. I don't want to be a salesman. TLS handshake, you verify the certificate chain. We now know how to verify the certificate chain. You upload including the root CA, so you figure out all the digital signatures. So the if you have a host certificate, it is signed by the CA, so you have to check if this is signed by the CA. But if you do this check, you need to figure out if this CA was legit. So you have to check his signature. And this CA before that was signed by another CA, so you need to check this signature, up to and including the signature of the root CA. At least, well, you cannot really check this, but you can verify if this is okay and install on your browser. And you can then conclude that the entire chain is at least verifiable and completely legit. Validity, time-based. Or is end revoked. You have to figure out the certificate needs to be valid at this moment in time, and you have to check if this certificate might be revoked for whatever reason if it was still valid. Here's an example. If you just view certificate on whatever browser you have, you can see this validity not before, not after dates. With respect to OCSP and CRL checking, you can figure out with a request you can get an answer, and the answer could be revoked, and this means you have to kill the connection because something bad happened to this certificate and should not be trusted. If this happens, typically on Chrome, you will see a big red blob like "Don't go further," and even Firefox Firefox will probably also hint you very clearly this is not good to continue. Sometimes OCSP services are not well in sync with reality or something, and they don't know about the they don't know about the certificate, and then it depends on the client on what to do. Okay, I don't know. He said it's unknown. What to do? Continue, be user friendly, or stop? Security wise, you would say stop. But people tend to be security friendly. I would say stop, but yeah, that's me. The other option is download the CRL file from the CA, check the CRL file, check the serial number. If it's on this list, kill the connection. And this is something that Chrome actually used in finding man-in-the-middle attacks on their infrastructure. So there were these dissidents somewhere, and there might be an SSL intercepting machine between them. And some of these Chrome users at least saw error messages where other errors were not casted in Firefox, for instance. So you went to the same gmail.com website, Firefox says, it's cool, come over here. Internet Explorer, same shit. Come over here. Log on with your credentials. While on Chrome it said, no, this is not a certificate that was ever given out by the Google company. It might be a legit certificate from a legit CA, but your CA might be hacked or something else happened. But this is not a certificate for the Chrome and Google infrastructure. And this is done by fingerprinting and whitelisting their certificates. Now how can Google do this? Google is its own CA these days. They're big enough to do this kind of work, just as, extra security for them. So they know what kind of fingerprints are to be set into your browsers. So they program a list of whitelisted certificate fingerprints. They put them in all the browsers. They put them on my mobile phone. And if something happens with this infrastructure and it gets man-in-the-middled by a legit CA, by a legit certificate, and this happened in a few cases, they can figure it out. And this is why Google at least had 3 times in the past now figured out that there was something fishy going on in some country while other browsers just went on happening. This is a complicated problem because if your adversary is your ISP or another big infrastructure or the government, then you have a bit of a problem because they can do things. Chrome has this feature, and there are other tools like VPN clients that do the same thing. They don't trust on the fact that this entire CA infrastructure exists. They just expect that certificate, nothing else. If it's different, they will give you an error or give you the choice to continue, accept the new situation, or just bail out. Okay, so then you have the entire SSL TLS handshake, blah blah blah. And then you have the other thing to do, which is check the subject alternative names. Match the DNS or URI for the IP address, whatever you used, against the URL you were connecting to. This is the URL you have to remember. If you go to www.kpn.com, you better get a certificate that is signed for that site. This is an example of the same certificate again. In the section certificate subject alt name, this is something you can all do on your laptops in your free time. And here's a list of DNS names that it supports. In this case it said www.com and it still has the old list. This is already updated in the meantime. Through fantastic workers. Lots of teams. These are the DNS names where it's valid for. In this case it's www.kpn.com. And on this sheet, it's still beta.kpn.com. And you get some information leak. And about info leakage, or whatever leakage, in this case, like the old saying, include everything, including the kitchen sink. Google uses this entire list on some of their certificates. So they issue star.google.com, and this certificate is also valid for star.android.com, AppEngine.google.com, Cloud Google, Google CA, Google CL, Google India, Japan, holiday countries, YouTube even. This is also a bit changed because I think I got this from YouTube. But anyway, this is changed. What's the bad thing about this? What's the negative side of this? Okay, Google can do this. Google has their own ways of checking a lot of things, but the bad takeaway of this is that this certificate is now valid for the entire infrastructure, the outward facing infrastructure of Google, the whole of Google. all the services. This means this certificate is very valuable. This certificate is a prime target if I would be an attacker to Google. If I get a hold of this certificate, I could man in the middle everything. All the services, all the apps, app stores, Android stuff, you the lot. Even your YouTube for movies. So be aware of the fact that some certificates are slightly overpowered. And this is a prime example. Anyway, it all leads back to trust. Somehow you need to have some bit of trust in DNS, although this system prevents you at least from needing full trust in DNS. It is very important that CAs check who they actually give the certificates out to. And the other important thing, of course, is administrators must not leak the private numbers. I mean, if you do this, basically the entire game is over. And you just gave away the keys to the kingdom, and everybody else could man in the middle attack. At least the ones who stole it can man in the middle of your site. Not a pretty sight. Self-signed certificates. People tend to create self-signed certificate as a solution to, well, not paying or not getting this one free certificate. The important takeaway is if you use self-signed certificates, this means there's no CA structure, there's no third party to trust, there is no way of building a web of trust with somebody else. The only thing you have is knowing out of bound what certificate to expect from the other side. Trying to whitelist this certificate, and from this do certificate pinning. Certificate pinning means you take a fingerprint of this certificate, and that no other certificate would have this, and you can expect this certificate, well, at least to match this fingerprint. So basically you're hardwiring your expectations on what to receive from the other side. This is according to specification, but it's not that flexible, because if somebody, for whatever reason, the system administrator needs to change this certificate, the certificate pinning will fail, therefore users will complain. The other thing is, nobody can actually build up trust besides this. I mean, I trust myself. That's basically what you say with your self-signed certificate. It's not really security. Doesn't add anything. Could have stated anything in these certificates. Quality of the certificates may vary as well with respect to low quality signing algorithms, chosen algorithms for the entire integrity control. Here's another thing called HSTS, HTTP Strict Transport Security, also known as HTTPS or BUFT. Does anybody know about HSTS except Arne?
Yeah.
Okay. It's getting more popular these days to use it. The danger in typically just going to a website and being redirected to HTTPS is this part. The actual sending a GET request on a website. And when you see the answer is obviously just in plain HTTP, no security, no SSL, just port 80, and it says move permanently 301. Could have been move temporarily, whatever. You are being redirected to the secured site. That seems secure, right? Well, not so much, because this stuff is unencrypted. I can man in the middle of this. I can attack this. I can change this answer into something else and say, you can just join me on my faked website, which is a front for, you name a bank, and if you are in an internet cafe, you could be susceptible to this one. HSTS works, at least on the setup side, the same way. You set it up. You're getting a move. You're getting moved to HBS. You can send your login details and whatever, and cookies, credit card details, so on. If you use HSDS, if you go to www.example.org, all the traffic that goes to www.example.org in the next session, in the next connection that you make, will be checked against a database in your browser. And if it has a notion of, okay, well, you have to use HSTS, it will force it to use HTTPS exclusively. It will not use this redirect message, it will just ignore it. If you go to www.kpn.com, assume that we have it. We don't have this enabled. This has reasons, because it is very strict. It's so strict that it sometimes is not that handy to use, but in some cases it is. If you go to the same website, to the same URL again, without typing in HTTPS explicitly, your browser will just say, oh, no, we're going to do HTTPS exclusively. So if you have a component on your website which does not expect and can handle HTTPS, it will fail. Your website will break. So yes, uber cool security measure, but it has a little bit of a downside. How does this work? If you have an HTTPS connection to your website, and you give the HTTP header strict transport security with a lifetime of half a year, and you scope it to include subdomains, for instance, you send over an HTTPS connection this header, this will get a recording into the database of your browser, and the next time you come to the database, come to the website, it will just go to HTTPS. And this could also be demoed very quickly. So if we go all the way to the top, we can see this stuff. We can see plain text. We can see a GET request. We can see the 301 move permanently. Nginx, line, move permanently. And you have the header as such with the location. Okay. So I didn't change anything, and throw this away. I now do a full reload, and notice the first message. This is the top. You can notice it at the top because the delta time of these entire capture is 0.00000 is that it started out using a TLS 2.1.2 handshake. Nothing else. So this is the difference. You are not susceptible to this first redirect in plain HTTP. This is very important to me. Yes.
Does this always happen? Like the initial, is it always in HTTP? Or does the browser have some mechanism that it's something that, like you do an HTTPS one time and then the next time it will be.
If I would have gone to https://website, I would have gotten this direct. And then it will never change. And then if I forget to type in HTTPS, I will just go to the website straight away in HTTPS.
You can also test this for yourself. It's enabled on our own servers, Home, Uge, and so on. So if you just wipe all your browser data and Wireshark it, and you can see it happening. You can test with it yourself if you want.
Yeah. So the other one is if you go. Yeah, this is where I did. Go get me this www.opcyberpaint.nl website. It will say, give me the site, and as you can see, no SSL handshake was done. It will just get the 301 moved permanently. Get a location, like, okay, go to the HTTPS website. It starts connecting. It uses this reasonably strong cipher solution. Service certificate, la 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 la. Get, and then okay. And this is the magic header. You see a lot of headers, but this is the strict transport security header that gets attached to this. And this is what triggers your browser to actually go directly to this page on HTTPS without compromise. So this is on one hand a safeguard, but I've seen situations where, for instance, WordPress sites were completely apeshit on the fact that you forced your browser to go HTTPS on this, while some assets on the website are fully not relatively located on the website, but they use the full URL starting with HTTP, picture, or some other piece of JavaScript, and therefore the browser will just say, sorry, but I'm not going to get this because I've got this HTST policy to comply with for your site. So I'm not going to get this asset. So if you're going to try this and your site looks all bad, typically it's because of this.
Yeah, WordPress, it's a known issue actually in WordPress. There's a plugin that fixes it.
Yeah, the two things. For this site, I completely rewrite all the content of the site by the server on every request.
Ooh.
Bright light.
I'm melting.
Any idea how horrible this would be for all my little hacker eyes? Alright. Demo time done. Okay. So, some people don't do SSL PKI that correctly, and they're gonna have a bad time. A few years ago, 2 years even, like, time flies. There was this abstract, the most dangerous code in the world, validating SSL certificates. Well, as you can see from my presentation, it's there are some things to it. So they made a study, and I didn't really, I don't really care if they came from Texas, Austin, Stanford, whatever university they came to. They made a bit silly claims sometimes. I was a bit part of the, more or less part of the curl community, and trying to figure out how SSL is working in curl. What they claimed in the study is that, well, if you use curl as a library for your back-end systems, so you go to whatever webshop.com and you now have to pay, what happens to the traffic from this website to the credit card company? What happens to this website, from this website to the other payment providers? You don't have control of this because this is back-end infrastructure call. So you don't see this traffic in your browser. This is the moment you click for the payment, wait, talk in the back. Then comes back and say, yes, you're validated, your payment is done. Turns out a lot of web shops used intermediate payment providers with insecure code. There could be man in the middle, values could be changed, you name it, the lot. You can see what happened between the traffic and the payment providers and the users, so the web shops, couldn't figure out, couldn't see any difference in this. This had to do with how PHP was actually calling and using curl. So the curl library wasn't really at fault. It had a bit of a flaky API maybe, but it worked okay. The problem is that the intermediate payment providers just, they didn't know. They were building on top of other people's code, and then you get these problems. The same holds for cloud platform controls, machine-to-machine interfaces, and other backend infrastructure using curl. Sometimes they didn't really figure, they just assumed, yeah, you should use this and this interface this way, and they didn't read the manual. And then, oops, man in the middle, or help workers. So they concluded on the thing like, okay, using curl is bad, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Let's find out. So I tried to figure it out. And there's this flag called SSL verify host. There's verify peer. This means certificates need to be verified by the chain. Verify host means match the valid certificate with the URL you are going to. Match it with the host name. So if the certificate might be completely valid but stolen from a completely different website, you wouldn't know if you have this set statement to off. And it turns out that the API was a bit, they always had 0 or 1, on or off, and for this particular value they used 0 off, 1 for debugging, and 2 for full checks. This is what you always needed to do, and this was the default. But PHP used SSL verify host is true. Any PHP coders? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so PHP is a very funny language with respect to casting all the way. If you need to move from a Boolean to an integer, or from an integer to a Boolean, there are many languages that do the same thing. PHP has an interesting set of ways of how to deal with this. Anyway, it turns out in a lot of these banking sites, banking backend sites, they use SSL verify is true. This means it's 1. Oops, debugging. I will report an error, but I will just continue with your payment. Youch, this means susceptible to man in the middle attack. It will report it, but just continue, because it's debugging. Oops. And this is where everybody complained about. Now, it turns out that libcurl, which is the actual library underneath the command line curl, has the capability of being built with 9 and probably even 10 different SSL implementations. AXTLS is used for embedded devices. NewTLS is used for by default for Ubuntu and Debian-like systems with curl. OpenSSL was used by Red Hat-based systems and OS X for many years until they replaced it and used NSS, which is not the nuclear security summit in this case, and all the other problems down the drain. NSS is the Netscape security something, and this is for Mozilla, so your Firefox uses this, and this is also a library being used on Red Hat by default. PolarSSL is used by OpenVPN these days, and a lot of other embedded device solutions. Even Android applications use PolarSSL these days. Very strong. CRSSL and QSOUSSL is a weird one. This is for IBM mainframes. So Windows Shuttle, that's what everybody is using if you use Internet Explorer or whatever on Windows. And Darwin SSL is for iOS and OS X. Over to this as the main solution since the Lion distribution, so OS X 10.8. I went through all the code that was associated with all these backends and libcurl to see if they were RFC 2818 compliant and do all the checks. I had nothing to do through Christmas, so I was doing this. This is 2 years ago. I now have a second kid, now I don't have time. So, yeah, reading the code for each of the backends, reading the libcurl code for each of the backends to see if they were compliant. Turns out to be AXTLS bad, KnutTLS perfect, OpenSSL perfect but different, and NSS was also perfect, you couldn't mess it up. PolarSSL at the time was not okay. CINSSL was bad. QSL SSL was pretty bad because you couldn't even fix it because it was closed source. So I had to figure out with the context of IBM to actually get to this source, but yeah, nobody was really interested in this. So I thought, okay, well, nice going and have fun in your banking mainframe system that's probably doing all kinds of bank transactions overseas and so on. Wait a minute, NSA. Oh, yeah. Shit. Well, we're fucked. Anyway, my conclusion. Windows Shell was good, Darwin SSL, interesting enough, good as well. KnutTLS, well, it's perfect, but there were things to it. Anyway, I fixed all of these SSL backends, except QSO SSL, obviously. And there's no more shenanigans these days with respect to the SSL verify host, so it's off or any value means you just switched on security. No more debugging. No more funny 0.1.2 API. It's also generally a lesson if you ever start using, if you ever start coding and somebody else needs to use your API, think about the human aspect of the understanding of the API you ever are going to be publishing. Okay, I'll move on. Let's go mobile. By the way, this Nokia doesn't even support SSL, if I'm not mistaken. Android does, but has funny issues. So, raise your hands if you use Android. And, okay. Raise your hands if you use EduRoam on your Android. Beautiful. Should have brought myself. Thing is, X021X, not 11X. Even people from the National Cybersecurity Center make typos on this one. Funny enough, in the whitelist, they call it 802.11X, which doesn't exist on purpose for typos. It's actually for typo reasons that somebody skipped the spec number. Anyway, provides authentication on LAN and wireless. Used in enterprise networks, SpaceNet or EduRoam. It's more or less the same thing. There will be another interesting issue. So there's another. So the thing is, Android has a GUI. Android has an API. WPA supplicant is what the Android API is basically reloading when you add new information to it. So if you change your password, it will use WPI supplicant, reload it, and rewrite the file underneath it. If you root your Android, who rooted the Android? Good. You have a way of securing yourself if you write the WPI supplicant file similarly to what you do on Linux. Android supports a variety of 802.1x combinations, like EEP, which is more or less Cisco-oriented, TLS and TTLS, with an inner protocol for PAP and MSCHOP and many, many more. The combination EEP, TTLS PAP or ETTLS MS Job V2 is what you would see in Eduroam solutions. If you use, if you have the opportunity here at the HVA to use MS Job V2, reconfigure your phone and do it. You don't?
It's what Windows tries to do.
I know, this is the default for Windows. We've been hating on this thing called MS Job V2, and then concluded, oh, fucking fool, this is the only solution that actually would beat attackers. Because PAP is clear text. TTLS is tunneled TLS, so that's more almost double layer of encryption.
Very good.
Very strong with E. This is encrypted. This is not. The thing is, Android phones have a flaw. So CA certificate, so you can set the CA certificate setting, credentials, client certificate, username and a password. Looks something like this. This is for my Eduroam stuff. I am anonymous. Doesn't work like this on Eduroam, obviously. TTLS and job, blah, blah, blah. But the thing is, if you use Linux WPA supplicant.com files, you have the option to set a subject match as alt subject match. This is for subject alt names. This is for the common name in certificates. This is, or at least the entire subject. Sorry, the entire subject, or just the www.hva.com or radius.hva.com or whatever it's called here. What is it called here? The only statement there here, which you can make is in Android, is I have verified the certificate. It was completely legit. But to whom am I passing my credentials now? Somebody who has oscar.kuro.com, start.com certificate for my own website? Your Android phone will not make the difference. Because it doesn't have this option. The GUI doesn't show. If you have GNOME for Linux or KDE, for a long time, these options in your network manager were also not available. KDE introduced them, GNOME introduced them later. And this means, yes, I have the certificate to which is completely trusted for my enterprise environment, but I have no idea if this is the actual certificate I expected to. Because contrary to websites, I had this connection URL that I could remember. But now we're doing wireless. Wireless doesn't have a endpoint. You have to give it yourself to the tool. You have to specify what it should be. I've been I've assisted the UVA when they when those guys, this is recorded, right? Okay. When Gert-Jan was creating the new configuration file for the UVA, he did not specify for which intermediate CAs it should be valid, and explicitly for which Radius server all the students which are using iOS devices should check for. What should they expect? What should they match? They should match something like radius.uva.nl. Yeah. And yeah, that wasn't specified, so I could just man in the middle them by offering my own Eduroam hotspot, setting up my own radius system, because I can. Redirecting all your traffic to this. If I have a pineapple device, I don't know. Does anybody know what a pineapple is? Yes, at least some has. Pineapples are wireless devices which you can set down and you activate them and they will attract all SSID requests. If you ask for Eduroam in the vicinity with a beacon packet, like, hey, I want to connect to Eduroam. The pineapple will say, yes, no problem. My home, very private network. Yes, no problem. I know this. Redirect everybody. So if you focus this on Eduroam, you can have a field day over here. With Android devices, yeah. So I can, the thing is, the TLS handshake doesn't do anything. So the PAP, unfortunately, is an unencrypted form. MSCHOP V2 is encrypted, but you can crack it in 24 hours on a dedicated hardware. This was demonstrated at a DEF CON conference. Fortunately enough, it costs you $100, and the 24 hours will probably happen, but there's a backlog, because it's a popular service these days. So you have to wait about 3 weeks until you get your cracked MSCHOP V2 credentials. Then you have a clear password. And what can you do with a password that you use on Edgerome? Yes, single sign-on is a beauty. Single sign-on is a danger. It's a risk. It's a helpful thing. But when you have open ends like this, it's also an interesting risk to take into account. So, that's a little thingy on Android. Yeah, so rogue access points, blah, blah, blah. Use V-Radius WPE for exploitation. Test it on at home somewhere. Yes? Does anybody have a Nokia Lumia? Windows 8 phone? No? I should skip this part. So if you read the fine print, the one you didn't read, it says HTTPS connections will be decrypted in a secure manner. Does anybody saw the South Park edition about the end user agreement license?
Yes.
It just won't read.
Comcast, yes.
It just won't read.
Don't read this shit. Everybody reads this. What do you mean you didn't read the end user agreement? It just says so in the web browser, which is native to the Lumia and the ASHA system. Now, how does it work? It's really traditional setup. You have your browser, your phone, it goes through this SSL proxy, it will decrypt it because that browser is installed with an extra certificate. And the extra certificate will be used to make this connection here, probably proxy your connection through this device. Perhaps they use a reverse proxy to accelerate your experience on the web and perhaps reform it so that the web browser can use it and display it properly, like Opera Mini. Opera Mini is transparent about this these days. Nokia wasn't really. Nokia didn't tell you they were decrypting your bank web logon sessions in Finland. Finland. So here's a bit of web log. Here you see something old name, Windows Phone Browser OV.com. They matched it, and this is for the Express browser from Nokia in Espoo, Finland. And this is the capture of one of those devices. And it tells you proxy agent Novaro wireless server with a Jetty server version 6.1.12.RC1. So if you want to break it, and they didn't upgrade it, they probably didn't publish exactly what they use at the back end. I think this is a bit of stupidity on their end. Anyway, how we get to this is somebody posted a URL online, and just from my desktop I could figure out how the sessions were set up by the browser to set up the connections to the actual backend system. Now if you look up Novaro, it's actually a company owned by Nokia, and they are very good at platforms, cloud-based browser platforms, rebranded as Nokia Express. Cloud-based browser platforms. Cloud-based, your browser in the cloud. Yes. Here's another funny man-in-the-middle attack on SFO in the US. Somebody went to went to see Facebook, and then boop, Equifax secure certificate not trusted, la la la, for SFO Gateway Airport.
What?
So if you wanted to go to Facebook, you were redirected through this this proxy, probably for SSL inspection, man in the middle attack as a service. It's slightly bigger story is a screw up at Turk Trust. Turk Trust, everybody loves it. So what happens was that somewhere in time there was a certificate for, oh, did you? You memorized the entire list of subject alt names, right? With the kitchen sink. Look, it's over here. But now, yes, US, California, Mountain View, started Google.com, but now signed by Turkish, Ankara, Ankara, EGO, EGO, Belgi, Islam, startup, EGO.com.tr. What? Google and Turkey, who would have thunk it? So this is this certificate, déjà vu. the signer of this certificate was this certificate. It was valid for quite some years. It had a interesting CN field with a wildcard, which is typically known for hosts and entities. It was valid for about 10 years, and it had a CA is true statement.
What the fuck?
And it was for some endpoint. So an endpoint with CA credentials. What the hell? CA plus a host and not even... How does this happen? So this was discovered at the end of 2012. Part of a man-in-the-middle attack was what basically... roamed around Twitter. Somebody mistakenly signed a host certificate with CA is true. Yeah, well, somebody messed up the Etsy TS102042 audit because it was audited in August. And, well, they concluded, yeah, well, something is wrong. And the statement was that they accidentally mixed test profiles with production systems. Hey. So they added the CA profiles, and suddenly they made a mistake that from this they created two host certificates with CA is true. One of them got discovered and got revoked. So they updated the profiles, they did a re-audit, they got a new request by the client for the certificate. But at December, so this is 6 months later, somehow the other certificate got used in an exchange service. So they saw this and it didn't work. The exchange service said, no, what the hell is this for a certificate? I don't want to use this. But somehow, even with this failure, somebody thought it was a nice idea to install this certificate, including the key, into a checkpoint firewall. What are you doing with a checkpoint firewall? Well, let's go for the sales pitch. The checkpoint firewall can... in this case, they claimed, they stated, well, we unintentionally activated HTTPS inspection. Right. This is to safeguard your company's assets, though. So there is, I don't like this technology, but that's a personal notice, and this is a privacy standpoint for myself. But you can, there is a motivation for SSL inspection in some cases where you really want to have full control of all your users and whatever they do on your company's workstations. And they sell it like that. And somehow, somebody actually told them, look, we actually installed it in that server.
I would like to make one comment about that. It's not just Checkpoint. Bluecoat also sells this. There are many companies that sell this kind of stuff.
Yes.
So.
Bluecoat and all kinds of other companies do the same thing. So it's not just Checkpoint, but somehow somebody didn't read the manual, and probably there wasn't the Turkish translation for a Checkpoint firewall. I think that's the actual, I mean, sometimes you can call it the NSA, you can call it all kinds of IVD, bad thingies, blah blah blah, but probably it's just user stupidity in this sense. Somebody messed up. Here you can see the Mozilla Foundation to be pretty darn clear about the statement here. Like, you messed up so hard with your third trust stuff. You asked for a new root CA to be included. We're gonna wait until the audit is done. You get all your shit together. And then we're gonna adopt the new certificate into our Firefox distribution. And if you do not comply with this, sorry, you're out. That means not just this root CA of Turk Trust, but they had many. And they would all be put out. And this would also include and jeopardize the CA infrastructure used for the Turkish government and banking infrastructure. So there was quite a lot at stake. I will run through this one slightly quicker. Did you note our situation from my perspective? Because there might be multiple perspectives, and I've learned a lot of new things over the years, funny enough. This chapter is definitely not done yet. So somewhere in Iran, in a faraway place, which can actually be quite beautiful though. Beautiful people. Somebody said on the Google Gmail forum, like, I got this problem, yo, and in Iranian. And he said, well, look, today I tried to log into my Gmail account. I saw a certificate warning in Chrome. I took screenshot, yes?
I took screenshot.
I saved certificate as file, so this was a professional guy. Thing is, these were the, the files. I captured the files. The files were like this. This is the screenshot from him. Windows Vista. Invalid server certificate. That looks keys. Notice it, the red part of Chrome. The redness of the projector is not really nice enough for this picture. Let's zoom into this corner. Google Gmail, right? He was logging into Gmail. Did you note our root CA? Did you note our public CA 2025? Start on google.com. And here it says for people in the back, this certificate is okay. Let's take a closer look to this certificate. We now know about these purpose things in the certificates, email signing, whatever, blah 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 blah. I don't know if you know about nmap commands. Does anybody know the capital X command in nmap? No, Jack, you should know. Not even. It's called Christmas tree. If you have TCP, you have these flags, sin, ack, fin, reset, blah, 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 all of it. If you just light them up completely, you could get past firewalls sometimes. It's the capital X command. And something similar to that happened here. Somebody just figured, hey, I want to have start.google.com. Everything. I want code signing. I want certificates for service clients, email, signing for other certificates, software publishing, we name it. Everything. I want to even do the time thingy, but I don't even understand. Signing for time object blobs. Everything was enabled and valid for 2 years. Did you know there was a CA? For all kinds of things, actually. They published themselves as the Digital Cyber CA. Even before everything was cyber, they already were hipsters. Digital Cyber CA. Digital Extended Validation, Public CA, la 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 la. G2, this is for the government. Koninklijke Notariële Beroepsorganisaties. So some notaries actually use this. It's my phone. Yeah. So for the notary, TTP, that we know, and they have the PKIO byte stuff. So they were a pretty important company. So they had commercial CAs, root CAs in your browsers, private CAs for customer-specific solutions, like the TU Delft, for instance. They used DigiNoto for their internal CA. And the staat in Nederland, the root CA was used for DGT, taxes, tax services, and everything, including, well, not this CA, but one of those CAs from DigiNoto was even used in the boxes they installed in taxi cabs in Amsterdam. Oops, embedded devices. They didn't really think of needing to remove a root CA from the embedded devices. There are quite some taxis over here, and it was pretty complicated. How do you explain to a taxi cab that its communication can be man in the middle, then whatever. I'm sorry, we just compromised your cab. What? I don't see anybody in my cab. What are you talking about? There's hackers inside. Okay, Operation Black Tulip, cool name. I don't know who pitched it, but still kudos for it. August 28th of 2011, somebody on the mailing list, which we saw, discovered the problem. On the 28th, there was another certificate for startup.google.com issued. On the 30th, Fox IT started forensics on the infrastructure. And basically, in the same week, browsers pulled the trust in DigiNoto CAs. That means if you are in the CA business, you're out of work. You just got ditched from being trusted as a trusted company. Because in this case, they didn't just pull this one root CA of DigiNoto, but all of them. So, if we have a look at the certificates list here, you can see there's a list, and they, in Firefox, they patched it and said, okay, this is going to be a quick patch, because we have to do something quick now. So they string compared it, and they said, well, everything with CN is DigiNoto, the heck with it. This is a DigiNoto issued CA cert. Therefore, don't let the user override the error if the cert was changed from the DigiNoto root CA cert and the cert was issued within the time window in which we think the misissuances occurred. Root CA stuff, time cut off, and they parsed the time. Why the hell did they parse time? But anyway, it's a readability problem. This is slow code, anyway. This is why Firefox is slower than Chrome. One of those examples. Return security error revoked certificate. So you don't even have the option of, okay, let's forget about it and just continue for this website. No. It's block it. Even for Firefox, you didn't have the option. 2 days later, Firefox, under pressure, and I actually know who the guy was by NCSC who actually pulled this one. I actually found him on the hacker campus on OHM. So, okay, well, I did that. Oh, you idiot. Any idea? It stated, let's make an exception. Let's make an exception for the government CA of DigiNoto. So this would stop the services for DigiD, taxes, and the other quite important things. Now, do note the date, August 21st. August 21st of that year, they didn't know at that day, they didn't publish anything, because the publishment of the initial, not draft report, but at least the initial report was 2 days later on a Friday. 2 days before that, they pulled this and they say, well, we're going to make an exception. If you update your Firefox now, you will get this exception, which means that for every certificate that is rooted as staat in Nederland, the root CA, it will just allow it and at least just return zero. So it would be just cooler.
at that moment in time, they didn't know how far the hack went. They were still searching for the darn hack. They didn't know if he was still in the network, okay? They had some hints that there might not be a connection on-premise, but they didn't know what he was doing. So he could have gotten and received and extracted certificates from the store, from the vaults, for this particular CA. They knew it was the DigiNotar 2025, because that was, there was clearly public proof of this. But there was no way, because it was all one interconnected management LAN at the back end, they didn't know if this one was jeopardized as well. The hacker could have equally chosen this HSM device. A choice made by somebody in the government, cool guy, he said, yeah, well, we had to make a choice because otherwise our country would probably stop, especially at least economically, there are a lot of things digitally happening these days. So we have a problem in our trust relationship with all kinds of services, not just DGT and the tax companies. A lot of back-end services use this stuff as well. And this is why they needed the exception. Microsoft did it differently. They scoped the software updates for the entire world except the Netherlands to be updated. Powerful thing for Microsoft. You can say a lot of bad things, well, I used to say a lot of bad things about Microsoft, but these days I've started to learn that they actually have quite some tremendous control about their infrastructure. To say, okay, everybody gets the update, except this little country here. You can also say this into a meme, like, okay, fuck you in particular. Other browsers took different routes. Debian just pulled it. They didn't warn the government. There were all kinds of people that just were not warned. What about it? One of the other things that happened is they didn't use path length constraints in the government CA. They still don't. I asked people of Logius, why the hell? But I didn't reach the one or two people that actually understand this material on the same level as I do to have an equal conversation without just having the benefit of a free coffee. Because having the free coffee at Lofi is probably nice, probably have good coffee, but to have an intellectual discussion on this material is limited to a few. The thing is, why wouldn't the attacker create a sub-CA? If the attacker would create a sub-CA, there was no path length constraint. Meaning, to recap. If you have a sub-CA and there was no path length constraint set, or there wasn't path, let's assume there would be a path length constraint, a zero. No sub-CAs beneath this one. All would be done. He had the opportunity to issue a, probably profiles would prohibit this on the HSM machine, but let's assume he had full control of this device so he could load new profiles if he wasn't that smart. He could use the CA profiles, issue a sub-CA, and then do the following. He could use the root CAs, the automatic intermediate CA distribution mechanism. Like, okay, here are all the sub-CAs, including the... Let's go to this picture. My personal offline, totally legit sub-CA. And two options. He could have used a completely nice looking sub-CA. He could distribute on each website, he could distribute this CA, this CA, this CA, the root CA would be in there. Because pulling DigiNotar's root CA would be one thing, but pulling the start and end of the root CA would really mean something. Because this one is in an HSM module, which is guarded by several safe servers. And start the name on the overhead CA, I don't even know where this one is hosted. Okay, I have some ideas. Stop with that comment now. But I don't know where this one is. And this one, jeopardizing this one would be a problem, real big problem, because think about the Uzi bus.
which is part of your healthcare system with your doctors and your insurance companies in this country. UZI Pass, which is should be embedded and connected to the APD system. But the UZI Pass exists. UZI Pass identifies all your doctors. It would be jeopardizing that system, including everything from the taxi cabs to your tax system front end back. Doing this means the entire stuff would be fucked up. And he could use this CA, because he could use the sub-CA distribution mechanism and create endless amounts of certificates from his home. Because he has the private key here. He got it signed by this one. I wondered why. Still don't know why, but that happened. Blah blah blah, forensic report wasn't really finished at the moment when they did that, later concluded, okay. Really part that, past that. So September 5th, they published the report. They concluded quite a lot of certificates were published, including stuff for add-ons for Firefox. We tried in Yahoo Mail. And a lot of other things. July 28th, OCSP responder shows Iranian users, and that's this picture from Fox.IT, kind of obvious. Maybe you can see the red blobs. See this pretty red area here? Oh God, the world is bleeding over here. Well, this is Iran. And can somebody guess why not just Iran was targeted here, but why all the other red blobs exist on the planet?
VPN?
Ooh. Ooh. So close, so close.
It's sorry. Now I can't say this.
Any Tor users? Tor exit nodes. These were Iranian people using Tor exit nodes. All of them, identified as Tor exit nodes. Even the Tor people somehow used this site. And the OCSP responder in their Firefox went through, well, Gmail, but somehow it took another route. So they weren't using the altered, changed version and adapted version of the Firefox browser, which is distributed as the Tor browser. Tor browser is also now updated for the same features now. But if you don't use the Tor browser, you end up with all the other blobs here. Or at least, well, everything goes through the tunnels here, and otherwise you would be here. So, how did that happen? Well, probably, Lovit is another company, Blue Coat. So Blue Coat cannot deliver hardware officially to states which are not in line or not on a certain okay list, according to the US government. Except Iran somehow, but this went through other countries. So how they actually got this fancy hardware is a bit of a mystery, but somehow Blue Coat had a very nice deal. Later I heard from people from the Tor project that they were able to enter the administrative interface of the Blue Coats in Iran. And also Syria. So not just Iran is using this stuff. A lot of states which are not allowed to have this technology according to US law actually have this stuff somehow. The fun part is to be able to look into these administrative systems and just have a look at the back end and see, okay, so what is this Blue Coat actually seeing? And this made Tor a little bit more stronger with respect to your privacy. So this one also has the SSL termination and inspection as a feature. Monitoring of state secrets, of course, yes. Monitoring a whole lot more as well.
To protect the children, don't forget that.
Yeah, for the children. Yes. Do everything against kiddie porn and stuff. Because nobody wants this, yes? Okay, good. X was the so-called hacker. And he seemed, the claim is that he gave the certificate to the government. Yeah, so I heard people discussing this and liking, okay, is this really true? Was this guy actually Iranian? How do we know? Through Pastebin. Yeah, he communicated over Pastebin and some others as well. Why would you do this? So there are still a lot of doubts on his communication style and if this is really Iranian, if he actually would be able to speak Farsi. So people don't really know who he is. These days, with respect to Snowden, people link it up to the NSA like nothing. It should be NSA. Probably they have the means to do this, right? Well, maybe not. Maybe they do. Who knows? It's a mystery. It's a nice thing it depends on what type of people you are with respect to this debate. If you really think that the NSA is doing everything, they have the budget for it, but still. There must be some limit. I don't know what this thing was. Anyway, so the password of the domain controller was prod admin. There are t-shirts with prod admin spelled on these days. They were very popular right after the incident. Operational procedural air gap. So they mentioned that they had a operational air gap. Yes, they did. Each HSM device was located in its own safe. They were all located in a bunker. Safe means they had a cage which was locked, and in it there was a terminal, and the terminal had power and a console, and this is where the tamper-proof HSM device was in. Fortunately enough, they also had a monitoring network to figure out if these machines were still running. They had one Windows domain controller to all the CA terminals. So convenient. It was only for monitoring. They couldn't do anything with this. So they had the domain controller, and that one got hacked. The password, they stated the password got brute forced. I think with that password, it could actually have happened that way. It's still up for debate, right? I mean, there's a forensic company which tells something about a government. You can also debate the report itself. Anyway, conspiracy all around. I'd like to stay, keep it real, essentially. So they reported they hacked the password by brute force. So the conclusion of the report is that these CAs were notably compromised. At least they knew they had traces somehow that he entered, or at least connected or probed or whatever their threshold was, to jeopardize, or at least state that these one were all jeopardized and owned essentially, or couldn't be trusted anymore. But the list goes on with all the certificates, all the CAs that they actually owned. So their entire company, with the way they were running it, with the way they used and connected this stuff, and how they performed the audits, for instance, they figured out, okay, but these audits are procedural. They were not technically in-depth checking out the actual wires in your data center and in your safes to see if it is actually a secure network. And this is a complicated thing, and this is also something to remember. If you have a procedural way of doing things and say, okay, your procedure states by management, we have a management statement that we are completely secure, it means nothing until you actually look at the wires. How is this stuff connected? This is part of my job these days. How does it really work? Why does it work? Which credentials were used to get there? should you be able to get there. So, however, in all cases, and also if you think about the attack itself, he came in somewhere, he actually seemed to have learned the special RSA devices with a funny protocol. So somebody took time to actually learn this. So at least I'd like to conclude on, remember, time and motivation equals do not underestimate the dark side. So if you want to know more about crypto and so on, and if you want to have a hands-on stuff, you can actually go to the Openbare Bibliotheek on April 6th to a crypto party. Crypto party means both explanation of how this stuff works. Well, you already passed this one. So you might actually start teaching others that are interested. Others who are interested into these crypto parties are journalists. People that actually write your paper. People who you do not wish to be intercepted by nation states. People who should not be intercepted by other journalists. Or just your neighbor. Or whatever. These people have a motivation to go to this crypto party. They have signing the stuff. So the Web of Trust thing, or anybody using Threema.
Key signing, you mean? Key signing party?
Key signing as well. So anybody using Threema as a solution for not Telegram or not WhatsApp? Alright, so I use Threema, I use Telegram, I use WhatsApp, and I use Silent Circle. Everything. Threema has a way of building up a Web of Trust thing, just like PGP, but in a more simpler way. Same holds for a few of the other solutions. And you can experience this, show this, explain this, learn this. I don't think we're going to do this. Yeah. It should have also been Man in the Middle Attack demo. Time. This tool XCA. It's open source. It's for everybody. It's for Linux. It's for OS X. I use it a lot. It creates a database, and the tool can give you create certificates for your own funding games. You can create your own little CA, CRL files, CAs files, certificate files for personal use, for server use. I created others for myself, and it's completely graphical. So if you are, well, I'm lazy. I know how to work around the OpenSSL tools on the command line, but I also try to be lazy and efficient. XCA is a really helpful tool that gives you insight on what type of things you can do with certificates and whatnot. And if you build up new certificates, or for your own website, you need to create a certificate signing request file that needs to be properly constructed, you can use it in this tool as well. Very easy. If you ever go to a company or something and you need an internal CA, try XCA first. You can buy other services as well. KPN also has beautiful Staat in Nederlander overheidscertificaten. They're actually not that expensive compared to VeriSign on the equal level. But on the other hand, if you want to have something lightweight, have fun with this first. And if you have a site or whatever, use SSL Labs and try to get as a high score, because it uses a scoring system. You can get an F to an A or an A plus. I have some sites that now score A plus, just because I have to as well. If I couldn't do it, who can? If you go to the kpn.com website, we score B, so you can exceed us as well. Arnim has, these days, quite some experience with this and tweaking and tuning, and getting his site to A plus as well. And it's really
helpful. Well, that was somewhat of a gag that we were outdoing each other, so.
Yes. So on ISC, we were trying to figure out who could get the highest score, and then he beat me on something. Dang it, how the hell did you do that? Anyway, so this concludes my nearly endless presentation. Look, we're infinity, right?
Nope.
Nope, nope, nope. It should be more fluent, but that's my graphical. This is because I have an Intel graphics card. Blame it on Intel. Thank you.
Any questions? Questions? For the guest speaker.
I want to go home. My file paper.
Think.
Oh, no.